Hello, everyone. This is Matt Gunlock from the 3GIQ podcast. I'm here joined here today with Frank Gao, my co-host. Also, I have Ajax Trueblood, the author of Bastards and Brothers, Chris Ieva, the company commander for 3rd Battalion, 2nd Marines back during 2005. And I have our company First Sergeant Sean Gregory, who is back with us during that deployment. Again, this is a very different episode. We're not trying to turn into a BroVet podcast by any means. This podcast, so this deployment, this experience has some that's is something that happened to me. It kind of shaped who I was, and it kind of helped direct me and later on in life, getting into three-gun USPSA, the practical shooting disciplines, trying to always better myself. So this is something that is very relevant to the warfighter culture. And in terms of practical shooting, this is the direction that the Marine Corps shooting team is taking in order to train Marines to stay relevant and to stay relevant in keeping Marines alive and increasing that survivability and lethality. So I guess I'll start with saying back in 2005, 3rd Battalion, 2nd Marines departed on a deployment to Kilo Company, specifically to Al-Qaim. And then you had Lima Company and Al-Asad and India Company and Usaba. It was during a time where it was kind of cowboys and Indians, anything goes. And it was just a busy deployment, major clearing operations, not the stability and support operations that a lot of people have heard on after that. It was much like what you would hear from the Battle of Fallujah. So there was a lot of action going on. And like I said, this is something that helped shape my life and my leadership style and how I raised and treated my Marines and used those experiences. And it's something that helped pivot me into the competitive shooting sports while still in the Marine Corps. So if before we start with the questions around the table, we'll start with Ajax and we'll go with Chris and then Sean. If you guys can kind of quickly introduce yourselves and kind of give your background.
Hi. So yeah, I'm Ajax. That's a call sign, by the way, from the Air Force. And I'm a retired Air Force intelligence officer, which is weird because why am I writing a book about Marines? I'll try to keep it short, but basically I had a 2007 deployment during the surge, and I was keenly aware of what was then called the awakening, still called the awakening. And after that deployment, I started to do a lot of research on how did this all happen, because the awakening basically just flipped the whole script, changed things for the better. And out there in Anbar, the worst province, where Al-Qaim is, the Sunni tribes started to flip. And by 2007, this awakening movement had swept across the country and things had changed very drastically. So I was very curious about that and started doing a lot of research. And what I say is step by step, I learned about the 3-2 battalion and its 7-month deployment there in 2005. And I've always been one for, I don't know, the ones that don't get the press, the unsung heroes, if you will. And I realized that 3-2 was an untold story, and in a place that was pivotal. So started a long journey to write this book and have since made all kinds of connections with the Marines that were there and others from other units, and have put this book together out of a long series of interviews and research. So that's basically. Oh, another piece of information you need to know is like I said, I was an intelligence officer, but also have been at CIA for a number of years as an analyst. So that's part of my background.
My turn?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Hey, I'm Chris Ieva. I'm a retired Marine. I retired back in 2016. I'm in the private sector now. You know, just to build upon what Ajax said, first I get like an email, or maybe it's Facebook, and there's like, it's from Ajax Trueblood. And I'm like, this doesn't make sense. this is, but luckily, you know, I knew it wasn't like a phishing because he's not that pretty. And I went with it. And you know, it's been a great experience for me both to, you know, learn about what happened, learned other people's perspectives. But for me, my grandfather, who fought in World War II with the 1st Infantry Division, at his funeral, it was that, you know, Anthony Ieva fought with Patton against Rommel. And I suddenly realized that, like, you know, a lot of our histories are tied by some of the generals and some notable figures. And what I love about this experience and why, like, I bonded with Ajax and did introductions is I like that this book tells so many different stories from different POVs. And I'm very committed to it because that was my grandfather's life work. And in many cases, stuff that we did in the Marines, those little actions are our life works. And nobody can ever take that away from us. No one can ever take that away from me. And I'm very proud of my service, but more proud of the Marines, and obviously very proud of the Marines of Company K. So that's my introduction and motivation. And I'm really appreciative of the book to tell the legacy.
Thank you. Sean?
Same thing. I'm a retired Marine, First Sergeant. I retired in 2009. I was lucky. I was a grunt my entire time and actually got to stay in the infantry as a First Sergeant. Usually that's the kiss of death. Pick up First Sergeant as an infantry guy and they send you to the air wing or engineers or something like that. And luckily I got to go to 3-2 and be the First Sergeant for Kilo Company. Same thing when Ajax reached out to got my info from Chris, and he reached out to me, and I was honored to be able to tell the stories of what, like Chris said, the Marines, because they're the ones that did all the hard work, hard heavy lifting. Self and Chris just kind of porting them in the right direction and give them the assets they needed to do the job. So it's been a complete honor to be a part of this. And that's a little bit, that's just basically my introduction as well. It was a hard tour, but it was, like you said, Matt, it was kind of defined, you know, my end of my career in the Marine Corps. So it's a pleasure. That's pretty much it.
No, I appreciate that.
All right, so we'll start with the questions. But first off, Ajax, thank you for sending me a copy of the book. Read through it, really enjoyed it.
Did you read the whole thing? That's freaking long.
Yeah, it is. So I'm a grad student in history at Georgetown right now. I read 3 books a week. So when Matt told me that he wanted to read through a book within 1 week and then interview with the author, I was like, all right, we'll get it done. So we have a term called gutting the book in grad school. So I did have to gut the book a little bit. But from what I can tell, it's very well pieced together. We can talk a lot about the research that you did, the work you did in piecing together all these stories. You mentioned in your introduction to this episode, but also in your introduction in the book itself, that you're an outsider. And a lot of people are going to ask, why is an Air Force intelligence officer the one writing this book? I would like to ask you, does being an outsider help in writing a book like this from this kind of perspective? And how did your background as an intelligence analyst inform the way that you approached writing this book?
Let me start with the second one first. So basically it helped me as an analyst, you know, long experienced analyst, putting different pieces of the puzzle together. I mean, that's what intel analysts do. And that's what I was doing here. So that helped. However, it also, I'm also a little bit of OCD in that I just researched it to death, which slowed me down and bogged me down in some cases. It also provided a lot of richness to it. So the reader is going to benefit from that, but it was pretty frustrating to me to go so slow as I poked into all these different aspects. I mean, not just the Marine stories, but there's a lot of context, operational, even strategic, if you think of it that way, of what was going on in Far West Anbar in 2005 and the significance of it and the overall context of what it meant for the war. So a lot of digging, possibly too much digging. So yeah, it helped me in that I looked at it from the larger perspective from the start, but that also kind of got in my way. As far as being an outsider, that again, pros and cons, I bring a wider perspective, which I think was very helpful. And like I said, I wanted to provide, when I decided to start writing a book, it's like, I want to provide the larger story, not just the firsthand shooter, I was there aspect of it. So I wanted to blend those two things. And I'm glad it's coming across, because so a lot of the Marines that I've talked to that were, they've got, I had no idea this was going on in the same battle space I was in. And of course the lower ranks, that was what you would expect, but even Chris just mentioned that, there's stuff that was happening that he wasn't aware of. So, I tried to do that. I think I succeeded. But as far as gaining access to the guys, to the grunts, there was definitely an uphill climb there. So here's this weird guy, like Chris is explaining. I think one time he goes, everyone's telling me that you're just a fake. By the way, you realize that people think you're like a, fictional character or something. And I'm like, well, what can I say? So my real name is Roger, which doesn't work very well in the military. So, I've just been going by Ajax for a long time. And I had to break down some barriers. In many cases, once they realized, what I was doing, and I'd say 90% opened up and gave me, great, not just stories, but the underlying emotion and stuff, then we'll get into that, I'm sure, but would connect me to others. So Chris was probably the first guy that really plugged me in to his network, but that just cascaded out. So this is a product of over 200 interviews. And being an outsider was helpful in that I had this wider view, but I had to, it would have helped if I'd have been a Marine, to be honest. I mean, if I could have said, yes, I'm a Marine from, some other battalion or something, or if I'd have been in 3-2, that would have helped. But actually that's why Chris and Matt and Sean, guys like that, really helped connect me and kind of paved the way for me to talk to other folks. Does that make sense?
Yeah. You basically, when they deployed, they had their command structure. Everyone knew each other. Everyone had their part of the chain, but then everyone goes their own ways, and you basically remapped like the social network component. Yeah.
I'll tell you a funny story about this. So early on, I was using Facebook a lot, and I'm kind of a noob. I still am in a lot of ways for social media, but I would get on chat sessions and I'd start hitting people up, and I'd say, oh, there's a guy, he knows that guy. And I'd hit him up, or, just kind of branching out. And one night, I'm sitting there and I've got two or three chat windows open. And this is actually with Warpig, which is the weapons company. So there's Warpig guys have their own little network, and I'm talking to a couple of them. And one guy is being open, and he's starting to talk to me about it, oh yeah. And this is all just via text on the chat mode. And suddenly other guys in the other windows start like grilling me, like, who are you again? Who the hell are you? Why are you asking these questions? And so I got one guy that's being friendly and two other guys that are just like kind of hostile.
Being assholes.
Well, I wouldn't say that. I really wouldn't say that. They're protective. They're being protective,
yeah.
And they're,
no, I get
they're
it.
Kind of like interrogating me. And then it dawns on me that I've plugged into this network, and there's like dozens of guys, and they're all sharing stuff. The guy that's friendly to me is also chatting. I'm coherent or not. Simultaneously, I'm chatting with the entire platoon or whatever they were. But then I set up phone calls for the next day. And in the middle of this, a guy goes, yeah, nice try, ISIS. Just like shuts me down, And I'm like, Okay, well, I guess I kind of got what I asked for there, you know, and then, you know, it worked out. But yeah, there were moments when, who are you? Why are you talking to me? I don't think I really have anything to say to you. Usually those worked out. There are times, there are certain folks that's in the past, you know, and they are not comfortable talking about it, or they just have moved on. And you just have to respect that, you know, and that's fine. So, but yeah, it would have helped me to be an actual Marine to play on that. But yeah, in the end, I think it teased out in a favorable way.
Yeah, it's interesting to think of the role that social media played. Like, all these Marines were able to stay connected via Facebook, and you were able to tap into some of those groups for WarPig, for example. But you also mentioned earlier on in your answer how some individuals that are interviewed in your book read the whole thing and said something along the lines of, I had no idea that was also going on. So I'd like to turn the next question to everyone else on this podcast. For Chris, Sean, and Matt, how did it feel to read the book? What surprised you about this particular account that Ajax relayed? And did the book change anything about the way you saw your experience? And start with you, Chris.
Yeah, I had read a PDF version about a year ago, and I had done some analytics. Ajax and I looked at it, and we sort of wanted to make sure that not so much like fair and balanced, but we didn't overuse a term. So I actually did that, and I really enjoyed the book. For me, I think there's a couple of perspectives. One, I love the fact that you know, I tried to rename retrans caisson, and then you find out the Marines just called it retrans anyway. And I just love little tidbits like that, just to understand that, yeah, just because you're in charge and you say something, it doesn't always play out that way. I was also very, very intrigued with WarPig, and I never realized how many times they're going in and out and the amount of contact that they had. So that was intriguing. I'm always very cognizant of Lima 325 and 325 as a whole. We probably served, Sean, what do you think? Most of our true fights were over there, and we spent, particularly like Sean and I, because we would take the leadership group and go fight in Haditha. I'm always interested to see their perspective, and there's been a lot of media coverage on them. And then learn a little bit more about, India Company and Huseiba, the tribal networks, especially, I wasn't as plugged into. So I really learned a lot. I was reminded of some things. And then let's just face it, like, you're reading this in 2021, and, you know, maybe Iraq didn't go the way we thought it was going to go way back when in 2005. Same thing with Afghanistan. So I was very cognizant that every time you look at the sacrifice and the fights, there's a part of me that says, wow, you know, all of a sudden a decade later, I would view what we're doing very differently. And probably my biggest reinforcement is we brought so many home. And the ones we brought home, I think we did the best job we could to make sure that they could, you know, move on with their lives. But even some of the tales of some of the Marines who had some weird incidents or are still struggling, that does bother with me. And I'll finally leave it at this. And speaking of Facebook, every day I see posts by Chris Ryan, Eddie's dad. And I am, as a father, I am just moved that, you know, he has supported that sergeant so well and is so proud of him. And all these pictures around Lake George. And it just reminds me as a Marine, as a dad, of the sacrifice. And sometimes people can't put it aside or look at it. They're still fighting that war. So to me, that's the most powerful emotion that I always think about Chris Ryan and Eddie Ryan. What a terrific man, what a terrific story, and obviously what a terrific Marine. I hope I covered that well. Just a lot of, you know, images coming that way.
Yeah, no, thank you for that answer. Sean, for reactions to the book?
I read the book. I thought it was very detailed, everybody's stories. I think Ajax captured, from my remembrance and recollection, everything. It was spot on, especially Kilo stuff. And I have to agree with finding out about Let's be honest, because we always thought India Company was the golden children. They got everything, and, you know, Kilo Company was running around. But actually reading about it and hearing everything they dealt with the tribal, I mean, we'd go there and visit, but that's just because we had Marines there. We weren't embedded with them. So reading about that and seeing what they really dealt with on a daily basis was really eye-opening. Because like Chris said, we were constantly moving. We would do a hop up in Al-Qaim area, then we'd be down in Haditha. Heck, we'd even go down to Al-Asad and run missions out of Al-Asad. I mean, Kilo, Kilo Company was everywhere. And, you know, we thought, you know how it is. Everybody's got their own opinion about who's got the most important mission and this, that, and the other. So, and Warpeg was always impressive. I was real good. I was real close with the first art there at the time. It was First Art Cagle. Knowing what they went through on a daily basis was crazy. Probably the most defining to me was of the chapters that I read most of the book. Like you, I couldn't get through it all. I just got it the other day. I couldn't get through it in a day and a half. But the things I did read, again, 325, just that one day, those 2 days between, you know, the first day of Matador and the second day. And like Chris said, I was really happy with our casualty rate compared to theirs. Not that is anything to be happy about losing any Marines, but I think we did exceptionally well to bring home the amount of Marines we did. And unfortunately, I don't know if Chris has, but I've went to a couple of the Marines' funerals since then. Unfortunately, we've lost more being back than we did over there. And that's the hardest issue for me is, we protected them, took care of them in combat where we expected to lose Marines, but then we get home and every day getting calls or Facebook messages from Marines and saying, hey, so-and-so is gone. And so that's the roughest part for me is knowing that, you know, we took care of them over there, but we couldn't take care of them, all of them as good as we did when we got home. So that's pretty much it for me. But the book was very well put together, I thought, very detailed.
Thank you. Well said.
Hey, Frank, if I could just one point that, you know, Sean had made earlier is I think it was, you know, there's luck in life. Obviously, Kilo Company was lucky to have Sean as a first arm who he is, but also this role that because he was an 0369, him and Gunny Lynch, like they ran so many, you know, mini sort of operations out of the headquarters that would be non-traditional and it's like invaluable. So I really think on so many levels at so many crucial points. To have like a first sergeant with strong infantry and solid background, well-respected. And then I also think as I was reading some of this stuff, like I like debate, like I'm an Italian from Jersey and just seeing Sean right now, I loved his opinion and we would go back and forth to do right by the Marines. And I think if they didn't have such strong staff NCOs, we definitely would have lost more Marines and the Marines that we had wounded. They knew they had with minutes there's going to be we're going to get you out and I think that helps in so many ways. So I just wanted to acknowledge a point that he made earlier that non-Marine audiences may not understand, even folks in the Army, that we lucked out by MOS and quality of character.
Let me interject a little bit here, some context for particularly for non-Marine and even non-military viewers. So let me just describe the battalion a little more. 3-2 is known as the Batio Bastards, or the Bastards of Batio, which is their motto since World War II, gained during the Battle of Tarawa. So that's why Bastards and Brothers is in the title. But it's a standard, if there's such a thing, but a standard Marine infantry battalion has three rifle companies and a weapons company. So when we're talking about these names, Kilo, War Pig, so you had Kilo Company, India Company, and Lima Company. So you had three rifle companies. Lima Company ended up at the beginning and most of the deployment stuck at Al Asad Air Base pulling security, which they hated. So they don't really figure strongly into the narrative of the story until the very end when they were released from that duty. So Lima Company 3-2 is kind of out of the picture. Then India Company is the one that we're referencing was assigned to a place called Camp Gannon, which is literally on the border of Syria, right up at the far western edge of the battlefield. And they were in this little, basically like Fort Apache, surrounded by a city and a lot of enemy forces. So that's India Company under command of Frank DiOrio. And then Kilo Company is down at what was called Camp Al-Qaim, which was the larger base. And War Pig was the weapons company. So in essence, the only infantry company that 3-2 had available to do operations was Kilo Company. And that's why they ranged all over the battle space and into the adjacent battalion's battle space. The adjacent battalion was 325, a Marine Reserve unit, basically from Ohio. So when they were talking about Lima Company 325, that's what they were talking about. They ended up Kilo Company ended up fighting alongside 325 on many occasions. So you have these three different rifle companies. Then you have the War Pig is the weapons company, and they were divided up further into mobile assault platoons. And they were, again, a mobile asset moving around the battle space and doing a lot of stuff that Chris was just talking about. So that's kind of the structure of the battalion, very loosely. There's some other parts we can talk about maybe later, but 3-2 was in the Al-Qaim district. 325 was in Haditha, further to the east. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for the context, Ajax, and thank you for your answers, Chris and Sean. We definitely want to talk a little bit about your guys' relationship as a CO and First Sergeant, how that dynamic affected your Marines. But Matt, I'll send it over to you. Reactions to the book?
So I learned... So I guess I'll start with, you know, it was 2005. I was a boot lance corporal who, you know, later on in the deployment got promoted to corporal. So my operational and strategic knowledge of the battle space was like minuscule to none. So kind of getting that perspective was extremely educational. You know, and it kind of increased my awareness of everything else that went on. Like, quite honestly, when Brian Stand got a Silver Star, I didn't know it was roughly around the same time at the beginning of Matador. You know, whether it's my own ignorance or just me focusing on, you know, everything Kilo, because all I cared about was Kilo and everything that Kilo was doing. That was my life back then, and nothing else really mattered except taking care and being with the people in my platoon. And I guess I could say, given everything that happened on May 8th, you know, nothing else mattered to me because we'd suffered, you know, huge loss by losing Larry and then having Travis Nelson and Doc Alfaro and Lockwood all wounded, all in the same instance. So like nothing really else mattered, I guess you can say. So kind of seeing everything on paper, and I'll be real with you, like, you know, everything, you know, me, Chris and Sean had, you know, a long career. And I think they would probably agree with me that, you know, while you're going through your career, it's one thing after the next. You know, there's never any decompression time at all. So you're just kind of pushing on to the next thing, and you're always focusing on the next thing. And so this is, you know, with retiring back in September and getting this book last week, it's kind of the first time I've actually been able to sit down and really think about stuff and decompress and let the feelings come out and remember some things that you haven't remembered in a long time. So it's brought on a flood of memories, and then it allowed, you know, I noticed that there's still underlying things going on from back then that I haven't recognized, you know. And that's okay, because recognition is the first sign of, okay, well, I recognize this is going on and this is how I'm going to battle this. And it gave me an opportunity to reach out to people that I haven't reached out to in such a long time. So it's kind of, we describe it as a healing effect, or, you know, it's given me an opportunity to just kind of sit back, decompress, relax, and reach out to people. And before we move on to the next question, I have to agree with what Chris said about you, Sean. Like, I've had very few first sergeants in my entire career that I actually respect, and I actually care about. And you were, I would honestly say you were that first sergeant that I ever had who really showed the merit of what a first sergeant does in an infantry battalion, in an infantry company. Like, you took on that role, and a lot of it I think does have to do with the fact that you are an infantryman first, but you never let the fact that you were an infantryman take control of your platoons. You let the platoon sergeants and everybody else do their job, and you truly cared about the morale and the welfare of the Marines. I remember many a times you and I would pass by each other, me, a brand new promoted boot corporal, and you're like, hey, what's going on, Gunlock? And like, you took an interest in each and every person. And for that, you know, being that first real experience of what a first sergeant truly should be, you set that bar in my mind of what it is to be a first sergeant in an infantry battalion, and I have to thank you for that.
I appreciate it. There's just one real quick thing. I know we don't want to dwell on stuff, but I have to say too, and I don't know, we may get to this later, but Chris said, you know, we had strong staff NCOs, but you got to understand that myself and Gunny Lynch showed up to that company and battalion three months. Gunny Lynch showed up about a week before we were leaving to go to Iraq. So we mesh and learn quickly, and quickly to the caliber of a Marine that Gunny Lynch was, or, you know, retired Sergeant Major Lynch, and myself and Chris and the XO, we mesh well and quickly, and you know, luckily, because that is not the typical best case scenario for an infantry company that's going to combat.
No.
Nice. Ajax. So it's very tempting. It's easy to characterize this book as just military history, but there's a lot of other aspects to it, right? You're writing about the awakening, which really is like a bit of a social and also political movement. But really, like, when we look at military history, Marines document the hell out of everything, right? But we don't necessarily tell a story behind it, right? We have command chronologies, we have all these reports, and all the things that happen are written down. But I think what you did really well was you infused this story of this deployment with a bit of a communal memory. So, like, individual stories and like individual experiences are really coming out. That being said, did you have a certain audience in mind when you were writing this?
Yes, a combination between the Marines themselves, clearly, and ultimately, really, that's who it's for. You know, I care. I would love for this book to really take fire. I think it's worthy of it. I think it would change a lot of people's minds about what happened and how they view things. But really, I wrote it for the Marines themselves. My father, also a World War II vet, flew P-38s over Europe. I treasure the firsthand letters, the letters that he wrote, the combat logs that I've got from, you know, I treasure those. And I know that anybody that's been in combat, you know, they don't have time to write all this stuff down. So, you know, I it's kind of my gift. It's like, I want to acknowledge them, honor them, and give them this something that they can take to their families. So that's the second audience, is their families and their friends network, you know, that are not military folks. So I had to kind of bridge two different audiences there. You know, the Marines themselves, who are, you know, they know every acronym, and then a non-military audience that if you put too many acronyms on the page, their eyes glaze over. So that was an interesting kind of challenge. But I really do believe that the general audience could really engage with this story. I think it's that's the other, you know, what I'm hoping to reach. You're right about the Marines documenting everything. It's excellent. There's a lot of excellent programs they have. And I can't remember if you've already, because I know we got some questions ahead of time, but I don't know. Did I answer your question so far? Or
yeah, you did. Yeah, absolutely. We can jump to that next question, which was, you're doing research on the Marine Corps unit. What's one thing that you were thankful for in terms of just the availability of information? And what's something that just drove you absolutely nuts?
I'll tell you what drove me nuts. And that is, you mentioned command chronologies, which is kind of like the baseline for any historian. You get that command chronology and you can tell, okay, here's the pace of operation. Here's the different things that happened and usually where. So those are very valuable. However, in 3-2's case and all of second regimental combat team's case, I think it was all the second. It was either 2 MEF, Marine Expeditionary Force, or 2 Marine Division, 2nd Marine Division. They classified all their command chronologies for that entire year. So, which was the stupidest thing. I don't know why they did that. When I ran into that roadblock, it was like, good grief. What, you know, and I could have gone the road of, you know, asking for declassification or FOIA requests. I don't know how to do that. You know, I didn't take, by the time I discovered that, I already had a pretty good chronology that I could work from. And then I built more on top of that from other sources and from the Marines themselves. So kind of like by the time I figured out that command chronologies are super important, I was already past it. But yeah, that was super frustrating. And frankly, it shows an institutional problem of overclassification that will continue to haunt historians in the next few decades as they try to sort things out in Afghanistan and Iraq. Because that's just one example. There are many examples, and it's so easy, as Chris probably has run into from the stuff he did, you know, in other places. You know, they just pull out their rubber stamp, you know, stuff's all supposed to go declassified at a certain point, but I guess it's, anyway, I don't know. So that was frustrating. But on the plus side, two big things. One was the Marines have, I think they still do, but they certainly were invested in it. The Marine Corps History Division out of Quantico is excellent in many ways. And they have an oral history program that they, I believe, are continuing, but they actually have historians that go to the combat theater and they're out there interviewing people. And then they continue that. There's people being, you know, interviewed across the country after their deployments, but even on the battlefield, the Marines have historians. And there was a Lieutenant Colonel Benhoff who appeared in about the middle of their deployment right after Matador and did a series of interviews with some of the key players. I don't believe any of you were interviewed by him, though. Is that correct?
That's correct, yeah.
Yes, I think he missed Kilo for whatever reason. But You were probably deployed or not deployed. You were probably out on operation. He couldn't find you. So those were excellent. I got access. The Marine Corps History Division was very open about that and let me have full access to those. And they were some great interviews. It gave me like a window into the minds of Colonel Davis, Colonel Mundy, but also, you know, Brian Stan, we mentioned, there's an interview with him. So just a lot of the key players, I was able to kind of like peer into what they were thinking at the time. The other big thing that the Marine Corps did was sponsor what was known as the Awakening Project, that was actually conducted by the Institute for Defense Analysis. And it's a multi-volume, in-depth study, not just of all kind, but all across Anbar, multi-year, and they interviewed dozens of key players. And that is all open source, unclassified. And it's just got, you know, I just dove into that for years, actually. It's a phenomenal study. And the Marines were, you know, fully behind that. So those are two great sources that that I leaned heavily on.
Yeah, that's great. That's great that you found those repositories of information that were really helpful. We've kind of jumped topics, but that's okay. Since we're on the topic, I'll keep asking. Can you give us an idea of when you started your research, how long it took until you felt like you had enough to start writing the book? Just how it was a lot of work, obviously, a lot of personal interviews and research.
I'm somewhat embarrassed to say how long it took. So it's something like five years to write this. I had already started researching, but I wouldn't say I had a method. In fact, that might have been part of my problem. I was very chaotic about it. Basically, just, you know, when I found something that was interesting, I just keep following that thread and just digging. But I guess overall, I would say, first, I tried to understand the context, and then I started drilling down into individual events or into, you know, certain stories by certain people. And then all these interviews I conducted, almost all by phone or a chat session, that they would unfold details. And I have, you know, many, many interview transcripts, quote unquote. I would take rough notes. I have horrible handwriting. And then I have to go back and type it up. But in that process of talking to a guy, taking the notes, reading the notes, typing them up, sending them back to him, he would correct. I mean, Chris and I went through multiple iterations of this on multiple things. So that kind of gelled a lot of things for me and helped me understand a lot of personal stories. There's a ton of stories that are not in
I was going to ask, there's bound to be, you did all that research, there's bound to be stuff that's left on the cutting room floor. So was there anything that was like really close to making it into the book and just really couldn't find it?
Well, something I regret that I wish, I mean, the book is a little fat already, but there are some untold stories. One of them, or you know, series of stories. One of them is, I mentioned the Lima company, the battalion's Lima company stuck at Al-Asad. Well, their third platoon was Beowulf, the call sign Beowulf, was the regimental quick reaction force or reserve force, whatever they called it. They were in action all over the AO, all over Western Anbar. And they were Lieutenant Wingate. I can't remember his first name right now, who I believe settled down in Virginia somewhere as a farmer. So someday I'd like to meet that guy. But him and his Beowulf platoon were, you know, hellebore reaction force, raiding, sometimes filled in. They were in some of the key operations, Operation Spear. So that's a really interesting story that I just didn't have access to, and probably couldn't have fit it in anyway. It's kind of like deserves its own little side episode somewhere. So that's one. I don't know. That's the first thing that popped into mind. There are others. So.
Yeah. I mean, that's the good thing about everything that you did, all the work you did, is you still have it documented. By the way, as someone with terrible handwriting, It's not bad handwriting. It's just in ciphertext. Okay.
Correct. Correct. It's everyone else can't
read it. That's all that matters.
I know. That's the problem here.
I don't write the shopping list for my wife. She writes them for me. Overall, though, I have to say, like, the way that the book is structured and framed, I thought, you know, you said you wrote it for the Marines, and I think that's proper because it's their story, right? It was their deployment. That makes sense. But you also paced it and you framed it in a way that would make sense to someone who had no idea about what was going on in the world at the moment. In the beginning, you kind of grounded people with a lot of the events that had, like, the attention of the mainstream media. The Abu Ghraib, Jessica Lynch. And as you're writing, you know, it's mostly chronological, but there's some thematic chapters in there, right? IEDs are a recurring thing, corpsmen, the themes of loss and grief. So did those kind of pop out naturally, or is that something that you like? How early did you identify those themes in your research?
Yeah, I wouldn't say I identified them so much as I had the original vision of the book was to focus on each subunit, each company, and there are certain platoons like the security platoon, call sign Chaos, the scout sniper platoon, call sign Reaper. So early on, I had separate chapters for those. And I kind of like saw the different companies as characters, as their own little, you know, and for example, chapter 8 on Kilo Company, the introduction to Kilo Company is called Fury because, and Chris has a whole story, I'll let him tell that, but that's the call sign that they operated under in Iraq, Fury. So after I had to condense things. So some of those profile chapters got pushed into other chapters, other sections, or sections in other chapters. They're still there, but just more condensed. So I kind of had to give that aspect of it up. I do believe that Kilo Company comes across as a very distinct character all its own. I mean, it's certainly shaped by the leaders, but it, you know, Kilo was, Colonel Davis, the regimental commander, called them the Fire Brigade, and they've already discussed how they were all over the AO and always on operations. So that's kind of what was going on with Kilo, and very tactically and technically proficient and very aggressive. India Company, as we've mentioned a little bit, had its own, you know, Fort Apache experience up there in Camp Gannon at the edge of the battle space, and had a different kind of personality. And then, you know, same thing with all the others. So the themes, like the ones you mentioned, I guess kind of just organically would come out, the story of the corpsman. I had a really good source, Jesse Badia, who was the senior corpsman up at Camp Gannon. And I guess I should refer, I'm gonna shut up here in a minute because there's a lot of other stuff to say that these guys should say. But Chris mentioned earlier Eddie Ryan, who was one of the scout snipers who was up doing an operation in Husaba by Camp Gannon. And there was a tragic friendly fire incident, and he was severely wounded and brain damaged, and was CASEVAC'd out, then medevac back, and had a whole, continues a long, you know, recovery. And his family and his father, Chris Ryan, that's who Chris was referring to, and how they've handled that. That's referred to and discussed at the end of the book, to kind of like not close the loop, but to talk about, you know, some of the guys that went home and the struggles that they faced after. So the Ryan family is honored in the book. So yeah, Reaper had its own. I was talking about Jesse Badia. Sorry. So Jesse Badia was the senior corpsman and was involved in rescuing. There were many heroes that got Eddie Ryan off that rooftop and into the helicopter to get him out of there. So that's covered in a chapter on Devil Docs. So those themes just kind of organically, you know, popped up when you talk about certain units and certain personalities and events that happened. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. And the way they crop up in the book is very organic as well. Speaking of themes, I'll turn this to everyone else for a second. This book captured all of you at a particular point in your lives and your Marine Corps careers. Was there a moment in this book that made you reflect on how much you've changed as an individual and perhaps how much the Marine Corps has changed as an organization? And Chris, we'll start with you.
Oh, yeah. You know, I think for me, you know, there's a movie about leadership. It's called 12 O'Clock High, and there's a lot of takeaways. For me, the biggest thing is sometimes you have to adopt a leadership style for the situation. And clearly, even though I may not have been always like cognizant, is, you know, Sean mentioned it, like we were before we deployed, we were fighting for every Marine, every corpsman, every training opportunity. We didn't have a typical cycle. We had leadership rotating in and out. We had a bunch of new joins. I mean, we're going to our battalion commander for drug pops and saying, if they deploy, don't kick them out of the Marine Corps. We need every single Marine. And you know, it's a little bit of a sidebar, but just think, like, we're a superpower. And, you know, I'm at Dermo getting old flak jackets, partly for effectiveness, partly for mental conditioning, to line an unarmored Humvee. So for me, you know, looking back at my experience and now being in the private sector, I think I've become a lot more skilled of knowing when to adopt those different styles. I still feel, though, that like speed is a weapon and tempo. So I rely on a lot of that experience. And what I tell my coworkers is, like, when you deploy for 7 months, it's like dog years, right? Like, you're not deploying for 7 months, you're deploying for 49 months. You're getting a 49 month experience for seven, right? Because you're just learning so many lessons. You're getting humbled so many times. And so for me, I definitely think I've changed. But the biggest thing is having a distinct moments and understanding why. And I think the book is also good for that, to paint a context on some of these issues to understand why decisions or other things were made. I also have to, like, when we talked about, like, the company, and it is November, right? Like, right now is the anniversary, the Battle of Tarawa. We have the anniversary of Fallujah. I think what was defining for me was 2nd Marine Division had an all-officers call right before the Battle of Fallujah. And the theme was, Iraq is okay now. The Iraqis have it. Focus on stability and support operations, SASO. And I think I've always been really good at seeing through bullshit. And I pulled my lieutenants, it was an officer call, and I said, you know, we're allowed to curse. I said, fuck that. That's not true. And literally the next day was, you know, when some of the things happened for the second battle of Fallujah, like, they were that sort of wrong on what we're doing. And my philosophy was, if we can fight with air power, if we can fight with demolitions, if we can do the high tempo stuff, if I have to man an MRE station, that's easy. That's chump change. So to me, what was defining is not always being like in the in-group and identifying like what's the reality and providing that leadership, even if it wasn't like lockstep with what some of the stuff was. And it's so funny because we're a superpower and we're roaming around 70 miles of desert fighting equal sized enemies when we're a Marine Corps of, you know, at the time, probably about 183,000. So I bounced around a little bit, but I hope I answered the intent of your question.
Yeah, you certainly did. Thanks. Sean?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I was towards the end of my career. I was at 18 years already. I'd been in some combat. I'd been, you know, old guys down in Panama, just calls, in 88, 89. Then I was in Liberia in 96. But this deployment was really, and I mean, those were combat deployments. Yeah, we took fire, but nothing like this. And you know, the kinetic fight we were in Al-Qaim. So it was very defining to see where we as the Marine Corps came from my earlier days, going out with the caliber of Marines that we had, because we had some, as far as I'm concerned, we had great leadership. Chris was outstanding company commander. Probably, I would say, I had two company commanders I remember in my time. My first company commander and Chris. My first one was now retired General Walter Miller, who retired the 2MS CG, and Chris. you know, me and Chris, and like you said, he's tired. We go at it back and forth about now and again. A lot of time it was just me keeping his room straight, keeping his shit up. Naval Academy. but there again, he would always, and the biggest thing is that leadership, he would always listen to me, and he said, "First Sergeant, I understand, but this is what we're going to do." And I'd be, "Roger that, sir." And we'd carry on and we'd get it done. And yeah, I think when you got that kind of relationship between the senior enlisted guy and the senior officer, the commander of the unit, we had the same goal was always there.
Yeah, mission. Yeah.
And troop welfare, and even with Chris, with the mission accomplishment, still troop welfare was always on his mind, because Ty always went to the Marine.
That's right. I'd rather
put a tank round in that. I'll put a tank round or AT4 round through that door before I send an individual Marine through it.
And that happened to Carabla.
Yeah, and that's the way we fought, and that's one of the reasons we brought so many Marines home. So to me, it was just at being towards the end of my career that this deployment really summed everything up. Now, second part of that question, the Marine Corps today, I'll have to say I'm glad I'm retired. We still have this. I think we still have the smartest capability, but I don't think the mentality, the mental toughness is what it used to be, in my personal opinion. And the new commandant, he's got his ideas. I just don't know why we're cutting some of the things we are. But I just think the individual Marine nowadays is just not as tough or as hard as they need to be to get through some of these. And some of that is society's problem, not just the Marine Corps, where our hands are getting tied. Like we used to always say when I was a drill instructor, Moms of America are making us where we can't do this, we can't do that. Yeah, I mean, some of the stuff, some Marines take a little bit too, but still, when it comes to, you can't, being that we've all been to combat, you can't simulate combat training. You can get close, and the only way to simulate it, to put restraints on them and yell at them and try to create that fog of war, and it's still going to not compare to what you'll be when those rounds start flying, IEDs start going off. So I think we have lost a little bit of that right now in our Marine Corps, but I still think we're still the finest fighting force in the world, but I don't think it's at the level, and it's not technically still at the level. We still have all the great equipment and all that. It's just the way the ability to train and push the Marines like we used to, we can't do any longer. And I think that may hurt us somewhere down the road. So that's my two cents on that.
Hey, I'm smiling because I'm thinking of two stories that I always remember Sean about. I'm so glad he was able to join. I think the first one on like the, in terms of being aligned, but when Operation Spear, which was, a throwdown in the playground, we're going in. The battalion had made a decision to take some of our AAVs. I think it was the wrong decision to put them in Huseiba. And we had a lot of Marines and evidently a whole company of Iraqis riding in 7-tons. And we had seen what had happened on May 9th. And obviously, Sean was integral in terms of the medevac, but also saving Marines. I had taken charge of that medevac, and we were very keenly aware of the vulnerabilities of IEDs. And even during that op, we hit some. But you all have loyalties, you have orders, and I'm pitching like our plan. And finally, like Sean pipes up, and you can see he's not like a shy guy. He's like, "Sir, the 7-ton, he's like going off on the 7-tons, and I'm trying my best to be loyal to battalion on this decision, but it was good to see this dynamic and this unseen thing take place at a leadership meeting to understand why we're riding and having to go into an urban fight in 7 tons. And I think that if everyone just goes lockstep and doesn't debate, doesn't push, you don't arrive. I think also, Sean, I don't know if you remember, and I forget the op, when we were going into Haditha and Blue 7-ton, speaking of it, had hit a mine, and we're likely in a minefield.
Yes.
And
yes.
I was like, I'm on the radio, and I'm like, First Sergeant, get out, guide this vehicle. And then you were like, this anti-vehicle mine, like, I'm like 200 pounds in the gear. sure as shit, I think you were cursing and you got out and you moved our vehicle likely out of that path. And then you think about shit that's just so common at the time. And I'm telling another man who's sitting next to me, get out, guide our vehicle through a minefield, literally.
Yeah.
And, we're cursing at each other back and forth. Probably my driver, Smith, and bodyguard cursing even more. But a father, a leader just steps out of a vehicle in a minefield and walks our stuff out. And that's just normal jogging, right? That's just normal jogging. And then afterwards, we just laugh about it because I'm telling him to step out in a minefield. But you know, that's type of some of the dynamic and some of the fun. But nowadays I look at things. I had a meeting with a very, very senior leader at Anheuser-Busch where I work, and the meeting occurred at 4:30 on a Friday. And one of my coworkers said, that's grueling, that's grueling. And I was like, we have a happy hour, we have a beer garden. I'm like, yeah, man, it's like a 4:30 meeting on a Friday, and it's totally grueling. So, life is sort of different in terms of the terms. But anyways, I just had to chip in on those two stories because I think they're funny. And that's why I was laughing.
I forgot about the minefield one. I was like, shit.
Yeah, it all worked out. It all worked out.
Would this be a good time to give kind of a chronology, a short chronology of the deployment?
We can get, I was going to have Matt answer the question. And then we can certainly get to that.
So I'll start with the second half of the question. And so I don't think the Marine Corps has changed at all. I think what changes is perspective of the leader as they gain the rank, as they go through the Marine Corps. You get that bigger picture. And as you get older, you always get a bigger, more mature perspective on everything that's going on. So that's what I truly feel. I don't really think that the Marine Corps has changed. The Marine Corps is an institution. It has its orders. It has its MAR admins. It has things to kind of keep things in place. There are aspects of the institution that changes. I think one way the Marine Corps has missed its mark is, when it started probably back in 2012. Yeah, 2012, and even a little bit before that with the tattoo policies and the tattoo policies was one. And then the way they were drawing down the Marine Corps, and they were kicking like combat veterans out of the Marine Corps who were out of regulations. Like, you were getting rid of people with all the experience. Like, the majority of the Marine Corps got kicked out, and now you look at the Marine Corps today and hardly anybody except your most senior leaders. Like, if I had been promoted my last rank, if I had not decided to stay in, the master sergeants and the master guns are the ones now who have the majority of the combat experience of what we experienced back then. So they kicked all those guys out. So what are you left with? You're left with a bunch of people who have the training, who have the knowledge, but they don't have that experience of what it's like to be in combat. And that is a huge hindrance on your combat lethality of what you're capable of doing in combat. So to the first part of the question, Let me go back to it real quick, just because it's kind of been so long. So this, you know, this was, I guess you can say, the most pivotal part of my career, so early on in my career. And it's something that has stayed with me for so long. And, you know, the lessons I learned from that deployment have stuck with me my entire deployment. You know, I've always taken, you know, whenever I was a platoon sergeant, when I was an 81 section leader, I took all those experiences and try to impart that knowledge and that experience on the Marines. And one aspect that really sticks out to me is when I was a platoon sergeant with 1st Battalion, 8th Marines, you know, I had one of my squad leaders come up to me and he's like, Staff Sergeant, I have to ask you, what was it like going through combat the way you did? He's like, I know you lost friends in combat. I know you had wounded in combat. How did you react to that back then? And nobody in my career has ever asked me that question. And I sat down with him and I sat down with my other squad leaders and I mentored them on, you know, I told them the stories of my time in 3-2. I told them how I reacted. I told them how we kept going on. Like, you know, when you lose somebody in combat, it's something that you're never going to forget. But I didn't do it in a discouraging manner. I told them, you know, the mission still carries forward. Just, you know, it sucks. It's something that happened in the moment. But you still have a mission that you have to accomplish. You know, your focus kicking down a door and going into a house doesn't change. You still go in with the same intensity that you did before, even if you lost somebody. And that's how I kind of shaped my career and grew my career. And that's how I mentored my lieutenant. You know, and I'm still in contact with that lieutenant who's a company commander now. You know, we were potentially going to be given a mission to go into another country where we were severely limited in what we were capable of doing due to the ROEs. And he was all amped up and like, I hope we get this mission. I really want to go on this mission. And I was like, sir, let me impart some knowledge on you. I was like, we're going into a situation that's a losing situation. Like, I would rather not go on this mission because we have nothing we can fight for. What, we can't go on post or we can't go out here with rifles and they want us to all carry pistols? What logic does that make? It doesn't. So it's always bringing that perspective of what can happen and what you are capable of and imparting that information to people, you know, and we're lacking in that field right now. You know, Frank, you and I did an episode about something that Master Sergeant McGilton asked us, like, what can we do to increase the awareness of marksmanship training and the type of shooting that we do and practical shooting in the Marine Corps? And you and I kind of laid it out and where the flaws in the system are. And the biggest flaw is we don't have the leadership that has that experience in combat today that we had back then. So I get, it's the maturing process. As you get older, you see things from different perspectives and you try and impart that information on the people as you get older.
Yeah, good perspective, especially since you went through the deployment at the beginning of your career. But speaking of, so we are losing a lot of combat experience. You know, we're getting into a period of peace. They're no longer handing out the National Defense Ribbon. We're going to have privates graduating from boot camp with no ribbons. It's going to be interesting to see. But so you and I started this podcast talking about practical shooting. I guess, you know, we can turn the discussion to that for a second. And Ajax, haven't forgot, we can still talk about the chronology. I just wanted to discuss this real quick. So in the absence of combat experience, in the absence of somebody who's been there, what are some, how how does training factor in to preparing for the next conflict for you guys?
Are you asking me, or are you asking?
Leading to your to the question that we discussed.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So I guess I'll start with the question, and I'll focus this toward Chris and Sean. You know, you guys have seen my videos over the years. You've seen what I've done on the Marine Corps shooting team, and even before the Marine Corps shooting team. You know, I'll ask your guys, you know, the question first, let you get a chance to answer. Given that you've seen what practical shooting has done for me and how I have used it to kind of shape, and not just me, I can't take all the credit, but like Scott Rader, Chris Scott, everybody on the Marine Corps shooting team, Alex Goking, you know, people I'm very close to, you know, seeing what we have done on the Marine Corps shooting team to shape marksmanship into the practical shooting disciplines, if that was readily available back then as it is today, how would you have used that, and what would you have used from that, from what you have seen in my videos, to shape the company to make them more lethal? And we'll start with you, Chris.
No, I mean, that work that you've done is powerful. It's impressive. I think the biggest thing with training, and Matt, I think we might have talked about it on the phone, is the amazing company video. And if you ever get a chance, like, you got to watch it, that Schneekloth put together. A part that I was very proud of is the Marines organically had a dedicated segment to training. And we trained in combat. So to me, like, we even, you know, sometimes you train to a point, you stop. Training was a part of what we did. I think you get better at it. I think we pick milk runs to keep training and try techniques out and innovate in today's language. To me, I would have incorporated this all along, not up to the point of deployment, but through deployment. I think in the end, it's about not only the technical skills, but the confidence, because you train for confidence in your equipment, confidence in your team, and confidence in yourself. And I think that the techniques that you're pioneering are providing that confidence, right? Like what you can do, how you can outshoot, how you can win. And then I'm a Marine. I'm about combined arms. And I think we shouldn't fight at a parity. We should bring every weapon to bear, and we should time it, and we should lean into our fires. And that takes a lot of skill, a lot of knowledge, and you can't acquire that overnight. A little bit of a differing is, I remember when we had the PAS 13, the thermal sight.
Yep.
Nick Vitale, a very gifted and smart gunner, I went to him. I said, how do you zero this sight? He's like, I don't know. Let's look at the TM. And we look at there is no TM. So we're trying to figure out, you know, the MOA, where Lieutenant Clemmie came up with an idea of using MRE heaters, and on the fly, we figured a way to zero this so that we can use a sight to an advantage. This is just weird, right? But if you don't have those skills, if you don't have those fundamentals, if you don't have that expertise, you'll just mount something on your weapon and shoot it, mm-hmm. and not really try to kill the enemy, not get at them, not use an advantage. So I danced around the question a little bit, not intentionally, but more just a different perspective as a leader on my POV at the company level, on what we did and how to do it and how I would use it.
How does the 4-second firefight figure into this?
Yeah. I mean, I had read, I'm not a Georgetown history major like Frank here, but I'm a casual historian. And I had read what people had said is that, look, you know, you're going to get into a 4-second firefight. When I tell my friends, I say, imagine playing hide and go seek in the home that you grew up in, you're going to have an advantage. And there is a natural reaction to seek cover. There is a natural reaction to survive. The problem is the enemy does a 4-second firefight and then runs away, drops their weapon, blends back in. And it became very clear to me that we need to win in that 4 seconds. And we also not only need to win, we need to isolate so they can't get away. And then we just kill them in place.
It was just very elementary. The training is very different because you're having to convince someone that, hey, at the most dangerous time in an engagement, I need you doing these sort of things. I need it to be tacit and implied communication. And you need to do it block by block, engagement by engagement. And I also think there's a lot of people who participate in the ritual of combat. There's others who are the folks who really, and it's amazing to me, like time to time, who see the enemy, see something happening, and you just got to strive. And I think that's the fun of, I know like special operations are real, you know, like highlighted right now, but I think the fun of being a grunt is just getting in and getting that fight and winning and then moving to the next block and doing the same thing. In our training, I always think of, we were doing saw marksmanship to win that 4 second fight. And we started counting percentage of bullets, meaning like we were going to grade accuracy as a metric by how many of a burst got off. What we found is the Marines were hesitant. They were taking too long. And then I changed the scoring and said, just get around into the target, but you only have a limited bit of time. Don't worry about your ammo. We want to win that 4 second fight. And what you started feeling is that people on a tricky weapon, squad automatic weapon, started leaning in and being, you know, super, super aggressive. And I think that paid tremendous dividends because it's a mentality. And you're teaching people, hey, this is the technique. I have to say it, Ajax, I know we talked about it. You know, the Battle of Midway, I become fascinated with. But one of the things I realized, it was after our time in Iraq, is between Pearl Harbor, Battle of Coral Sea, they realized the Japanese had a better fighter. And they just trained and invented this tactic called the thatch weave. They just said, hey, we're going to put one plane on full throttle and we're going to be, those are the bad guys, the Japanese, and we're going to do it half throttle and we're going to figure out how to win. That's American innovation. And I think we did that a lot in Kilo Company. How do we win when an enemy has so many advantages and their IED only has to be right once, you know, across 100. So yeah, the 4 second firefight was our mentality. I still use it today in work I do, like let's win immediately. And then we can figure shit out on the back end.
Sean.
Yeah. I mean, I think our training, that we did pre-deployment was spot on. And like, Chris said, we constantly train, even when we weren't out squad leaders, platoon sergeants, we were using the ranges, we were using the buildings. Training is continuous no matter where you're at or what you're doing. You can't get complacent. You can't think, oh, I'm good enough. You're never good enough, right? Because it doesn't take one thing to put you down. More centric to your question, Matt, the shooting techniques and what you're using now, I think they're great, and I think they would have been very handy to have. But I've always said in the Marine Corps, you know, everybody talk about force recon, direct action. Now you got the raiders and all that. The big difference is funding and getting the ammo to shoot all the time. If you gave me the money and the ammo and the ranges, and I could go out and shoot whenever I want all day long, I could have everybody just as lethal as those guys right there. Yep. But that's what everybody comes down to, is the time to train and the assets, the ammo, and the ranges to do it. The techniques are phenomenal, and I think they would help. And man, you know, the Marine Corps is starting to use them from what I've seen, because I still kind of work on base around them. So, but I think that's the only drawback to it. I think the techniques and everything are outstanding, and I think they would greatly enhance the marksmanship capabilities. However, it all comes down to budget, money, availability, and things of that nature.
No, I can agree with you there. And I guess I'll add a follow on, or I'll just add a comment to it. And, you know, the RCO was such a pivotal tool that came out roughly around the time whenever we deployed then. Prior to deployment, we were all still kind of using iron sights and everything. And then whenever we got in country, that's whenever we fell in onto a lot of the optics. that we were using over there, which was the, you know, ACOG as we called it back then, RCO as we call it now. And there wasn't, you know, we learned to train in country through the fight with those optics, but I can remember in 2007 when I was in 1st Battalion, 9th Marines, that's whenever I really fell in on an R, you know, the whole battalion at that point was equipped with RCOs. And the first real training I had with that optic was in 1st Battalion, 9th Marines, you know, utilizing the SETI lines, you know, what, you know, not just using it as a battle, you know, optic, and understanding each steady align, but understanding, you know, we talk about it with Mike Pannone, Frank, you know, whenever you, I can't think of the term right now, might be the bourbon, but the occluded sight, you know, that was the first time I occluded a sight, and, you know, really learning the bend and aiming concept, and, you know, keeping both eyes open and shooting at targets from 25, 50, 100 yards with an occluded sight, you know, really learning how to use that optic for what it's worth. And then, you know, learning how to use each steady align for each yard line. That's whenever we really started getting training on it. It was well after it was fielded. And I'll even go further saying, you know, recently the Marine Corps signed the contract to get the squad combat optic, and, you know, talking to a couple friends that have that optic, they still haven't been properly trained on how to utilize that optic. You know, I'll be the one, you know, the black sheep of the bunch saying, I don't agree with having capped sights or not sights, but capped turrets. To me, having capped turrets doesn't allow Marines to really understand how to use the sight properly and dial if they need to dial. It's just fundamentally incorrect, in my opinion. Granted, you should, you know, in three gun and two gun and any of the practical shooting disciplines, you're utilizing that reticle to get on target. But, you know, if you're in a situation where you're having to dial, well, you're not having that ability because they just cap your turrets. It makes it more rugged in all sense of it, but, you know, they're taking control away from the Marines. And a lot of it comes down to, oh, well, you know, they don't need to know how to learn. They don't need to learn that. And I kind of disagree with that thought process. Trust the Marine that the Marine can learn something. Have faith in your Marines. It kind of comes down to the whenever, you know, the gas tube to the 249 saw, whenever they, you know, before you used to be able to adjust the gas on the saw, and then they makes it a fixed gas tube because they just took another level of control away from the Marine. Like, trust in your Marines to make a decision. Don't take a capability away from them.
Yeah, I'm not sure if you all are familiar with the new rifle qual, but it requires you to start at the 500-yard line. So your knowledge of that RCO, and you kind of have to be dialed in. You have to know exactly where you're hitting at 500. You don't have the luxury of starting at the whatever the 100 and 200 and walking all the way back. Ajax, you mentioned you wanted to discuss a bit of chronology. Over to you.
Yeah, but before I do that, I just want to focus a little bit in the absolute terror of Chris Ieva in a boardroom thinking about the 4-second firefight and what that might entail.
Oh, yeah, I'm like, savvy not to talk. I got called a nerd about a year ago, a data nerd. You know, but anyways, I think the same thing is true is, you know, in Matt sort of hit on it, Sean hit on it, is when Marines have confidence with their weapons, they're going to do great things. And then I think some of the shooting techniques, I mean, I was a lieutenant in Hawaii in 3-3, and a lot of the ranges that we used were very highly controlled, certainly when you go to Japan. I mean, talk about terrifying. Is being a mortar platoon commander and having four Japanese guys standing behind you with some tripod, and I'm just waiting to end my career by shooting out or shooting into a plane that's coming into Tokyo. But I learned my profession, right? I learned it in peacetime. I had a lot of good mentors. And in order to bring in higher firepower, in order to coordinate fires, I needed to know safety. I needed to know the performance. I needed to know these technical factors. And, you know, talk about like regrets. I wish I used my rifle less and my plexiglass map more to really bring more to bear on the enemy. So, you know, again, I think these are lessons that I apply all the time. But if I didn't have a high technical knowledge of my profession, we couldn't do the things that we do. And then, you know, you're it's not marksmanship, but you're hugging earth and you're thinking of a JDAM coming down 100 meters from you and just hoping and praying that, you know, everything works out and that you're not too tired, you're not too physically stressed. And that's just the start of the action where you got to pick your body up and move to that building. So I definitely learned those lessons.
Thank God for Flats. He was a great tech.
Yeah, without a doubt. Without a doubt.
Yeah. Let me just for the viewers give some kind of a chronology time frame of all this. So 3-2 arrives in Iraq in February of 2005. This is a couple months, 4 months after the Battle of Fallujah, which everybody remembers. But it kind of sucked all the attention away from everything else that was going on. It had sucked units and resources into the Fallujah. So 3-2 arrives and is part of Regimental Combat Team 2. The whole effort out there in far west Iraq is far western Anbar province is an economy of force mission. So they're short manned. Everybody is. And they start their, battlefield orientation, and they are right away into the gunfight. They lose a guy in March, and April. More, I think Kilo was in its first. I can't remember when your first operation is.
April. Our first major operation was April.
Yeah, the named operation. Yeah,
Outer Banks,
and then. In early May, late April, early May, the regiment decides to do a major operation. I should back up. There's a major suicide attack in April on April 11th against Camp Gannon up there on the border. Three suicide vehicles attack the base or the firm base and are repulsed, but very close run thing. So They start to understand that the Al-Qaeda in Iraq, this is Zarqawi's outfit, is basically trying to take over the district, trying to take over Al-Qaim. Al-Qaim actually is a district. It's not just a town. And so they realize they're fighting against the foreign fighters that are coming across from Syria and establishing what they call the rat line from the Syrian border all the way into Baghdad, funneling men, arms, and suicide bombers all the way down the Euphrates and into Baghdad. So the first big operation that the battalion puts together along with the regiment is Operation Matador, which kicks off on May 8th, which happens to be Mother's Day. And they want to cross the river. I won't go too much in detail. They want to cross the river and get into an area called Ramana, which they think is a terrorist safe haven. And they end up in a hasty assault in a town called New Ubaidi, which is where they have the very intense actions that kind of you alluded to, Matt, losing Larry Philippon. And then for the next, I think it's 4 or 5 days, they actually cross the river. They go through all of Matador, Operation Matador, which was a mixed... There were some pros and cons to Operation Matador. You can talk about that. I was thinking maybe we could throw that picture up that I sent you, Matt.
Yep.
At the end of Operation Matador, Chris and his officers, I believe it's at the end. Chris, you can correct me. At some point, you take this picture. This is Chris there on the, I think it's the left. I don't know how it turns out in the internet. That's Chris and his officers. Now, this is right at the end of the operation when they've just come out of the field. They're fatigued. They're, they've seen a lot of stuff that's happened, some harrowing things, an AAV that was blown up from the other battalion, lost a lot of guys there. So some real hairy stuff. And now this is them, right at the end there. And Chris, you want to introduce those players there?
Yeah, I kind of like this picture because, Nate Smith is dead center in the middle. I like that, just it's sort of not like built around like the company commander, but from I guess my perspective, pardon me, from left to right is myself and then my executive officer, John Hayes. And then we have Nate Smith from second platoon, Mark Bullock in the back, who's a pretty tall and big guy, college football player. And then we, on the right, we have Joseph Clemmy, blue. And then we have Clint Cummings. And it should be noted that he has like a small radio because he's not only like the weapons platoon commander, but leader of our like fire support team, which was so important. So, I like this picture. If you were to look on my office wall right now, I keep it. I think also would sort of need for maybe the viewers is if you look at my right breast on my flak vest, the MAP pens. Using the rifle less and really coordinating and understanding, copying stuff down when you're extremely fatigued. And, when we say you're out for 5 days, what's remarkable in retrospect for me now is there's no control. There's no timeouts. There's no, okay, we take a rest. You're on the go for 5 days straight. And prior to this, I mean, Sean, I don't know how many weeks it was. We were down in Haditha for probably at least 2 weeks. So you're operating in the field for 2 to 3 weeks, 70 miles east, pick up, and 3 days later, you're thrown into a high-tempo combat operation. So, it is a month of fatigue that you're really probably sort of seeing or not seeing.
Here. Yeah. So that's this image is on the cover of the book. So there has been a lot of, reasons why I chose this, but Chris just hit a lot of them. So this is, like I said, at the end of Matador, and you don't have to leave it up, however it works. But that was the image I chose, not because they're officers. I know some, I've got some flack about that, but because they're battle hardened Marines after a very intense operation and a group of brothers, from the battlefield. So, after Matador, they didn't really find the enemy. They didn't find the safe haven they thought they were going to find. In some ways, they'd kind of tipped their hand and they'd fled. But a month later, they do another bigger operation called Operation Spear. There was actually another operation in between that. Which one was that? I can't remember, Chris. The one down in Haditha you guys went to.
I don't know if it was Market.
Market Garden, New Market. Sorry,
New Market. Yeah,
New Market. And Kilo runs down there to Haditha and then comes back for Operation Spear. And this was, they really found kind of the headquarters of the AQI in Al Qaim district, and it was in a city called Karbala. And so Operation Spear starts on June 17th, and they basically go into essentially a Fallujah light scenario, if you want to think of it that way, but clearing a city with dug in insurgents that are waiting for them. And that took another 5 or 6 days. And there's some very intense action, lost another Marine there from Kilo Company, Adam Crumpler. They push on through that they found some absolute vital documents in this AQI headquarters that they cleared, some prisoners that they rescued, some hostages that were being tortured, not by the Marines, by Al-Qaeda. And then the roll into more operations after that. Kilo is just constantly moving from one operation to another. And at the kind of about this time is when India Company up in Husaba starts an engagement. They had begun an engagement before, but it starts to actually come into fruition, an engagement with a Sunni tribe called the Albu Mahal. And very tentative at first, but that relationship grows over July into August. And by August, mid-August, this tribe, which has their own little militia, they've been fighting against AQI themselves. And they kind of forge India Company and Captain Diorio forge a tentative cooperation, if you will, with the Albu Mahal tribe. And they kind of join forces to try to kick AQI out of Husaba. At the very end of August, you have a big backlash where Zarqawi, it's debatable whether Zarqawi was actually there or not, but he certainly had his emirs there, and they pull in a whole bunch of forces from all over Iraq to basically surge into Husaba and take over the battle space. So there's a big fight right at the end of their deployment in August of 2005, where Al-Qaeda comes in, guns blazing, into Husaba, and they did kick the Albu Mahal out. So then by September, that's when 3-2 has to, they're redeploying. They turn it over to a new battalion called 3-6, which takes over and basically picks up where India Company left off to establish this Albu Mahal and the tribesmen, some kind of better relationship with them. And within another month or two, have pretty much turned things around again. The battlefield just swings one way, then the other way. And this is at the end of the book describing how 3-6, building on the success that 3-2 had done, puts together a cooperative, almost like an alliance, and the tribe flips completely and now is on the coalition side. And that is what I term the awakening before the awakening. That happens out in Al-Qaim that 3-2 built the foundation for. 3-6 capitalized on it and built further and was very successful. And by the end of 2005, early 2006, Al-Qaim had basically turned into kind of a little peaceful haven. There's Marines in the early part of 2006 that are downtown Husaba eating at kiosks. And that set the stage for the Great Awakening that happened later in 2006 in Ramadi that a lot of people have heard of. So you had this awakening before the awakening, and that's why the deployment of 3-2 was so pivotal. Pivotal time, pivotal place, and had these strategic effects. Now, I know that they didn't seem that way at the time. Kilo Company is out there, very kinetic, fighting like Chris was talking about, almost at parity with very well-armed Al-Qaeda-led insurgents that were fighting to the death. And India Company is still very kinetic because they're defending this little firm base, but also doing a more, engagement type with this tribe. So the kind of the two sides, kinetic and non-kinetic, working together, set the stage. So it really was a turning, it's overused in history, but turning point. And 3-2 was right there at the crux when things started to change. And then it was obvious after that in 2006 and then early 2007 is when the surge starts. So pretty historic and pivotal moments that these guys lived through.
Hey, Ajax, I would add one other thing is I think it might have been July, late July, but Lima 3-2 returns.
Correct.
Right. And for us, when Ajax paints these things,
we're fully, you know, Kila Company had a man, a retrans site. So there's a squad fully committed, no electricity on its own, you know, 24/7 for 7 months, had to guard the camp. And then in between there, we're running raid cycles. In between there, we're doing QRFs for special forces, special operation forces. And then, you know, July, for me, the arrival of Lima 3-2, and Sean Hankert is just a solid officer, you know, as a peer. Now they could start chipping in. And I think our raid cycle, some of it, you know, in support of other forces, and some of it was, we learned a lot of things. We were, you know, really good fighters. We increased our raid tempo all throughout August. I still have to look at the JSOC raid, the casualties that they took the night before Al-Qaeda pushed into Husseiba.
August 25th.
Yeah, thank you for the date. It's like a what-if scenario, right? Like if that raid had gone off and they had gotten that leadership, they decided to do a ground movement. I'll be honest, one of my life regrets was I pushed hard with Colonel Mundy. I pushed hard with Major Day. I wanted to go action that target. I felt strongly about it when they took their casualties. You know, I wanted to, and the fact that we didn't, it was tough. It was tough as a Marine because 3-6 on deck. And I just wondered if we could have expedited the cycle that Ajax just portrayed had we gotten those targets that night. And it's tough at the, you know, let's talk about reality. You know, my grandfather, he said that during World War II, you know, they were all sort of recruited and they didn't care about awards until your awards counted to when you could go home or not go to fight in the Pacific theater. So all of a sudden, you know, my grandfather was saying that, like, they started, hey, remember this happened, remember this Purple Heart. No one likes to do stuff at the end of the deployment. It feels like bad juju. So August 25th, we're going home in early September, and there was a hesitancy, but I really wanted to go after that target badly, even though we took those casualties from JSOC in Husseiba. You know, I thought I could get a company minus on that target real quick because of the seniority of it. So who knows who it could have been, but I regret that to this day.
Let me put another layer of context here. So parallel to what 3-2 was doing and parallel to what the regiment was doing, the RCT2, was another campaign, the soft guys. So this is, you know, task force types, tier one, that were out there hunting Zarqawi. They had their own command structure, clearly, and they had their own assets, but they were interlaced. The conventional side, you know, alongside the Marines, were these JSOC guys that were out there in the battle space doing their raids. And Stanley McChrystal writes about it in his memoir that, you know, this was the first time that they actually thought of themselves executing a campaign. So there was a special ops campaign and the conventional campaign interlaced and parallel. So that's part of what Chris is referring to there.
Yeah, you guys have kind of hit on some of the questions I had coming up, so we're gonna skip a few forward. Ajax, for you, how important was it interviewing individuals involved with all different levels of the war? You make reference to, you know, tactical, operational, strategic levels. And then you seem to have gotten a good spread of different ranks and different parts of the conflict. Is that something that just came up organically, or is that something that you had to, like, purposely seek out?
Well, let me flip it a little bit here. When I began the book, I thought it was going to be a fairly, you know, linear, okay, they did this, then they did this, then they did this, and, you know, we're wrapping it up, and then book is done. That's why I thought I could do it in a year. And Chris was the first one that really, as we talked and as we did these rapid fire, he has a very interesting texting style. He does these rapid fire, like a German MG42 texting comes in here, like a rapid rapid pace. So we had a lot of long sessions like that. And I just realized all the layers of emotion underneath. And I changed my approach to the book. It wasn't all just about the facts. It was about the experiences, the emotions, the feelings underneath the facts and what these guys went through. And I decided that was really important to convey those, to interweave those stories. So that's why I did so many interviews at all these different levels. And I started kind of backwards. I think most military historians would do, you know, would start at the top, the battalion commander, you know, the staff, all the company commander, you know, and trickle down. And I had kind of already met these, I mentioned those, that strange chat session earlier with the War Pig guys, but was already Facebooking with the guys who had been Lance Corporals back then. So I was starting to get the grunt level view and their stories. So that's kind of where I built from, the base up. And Chris was an exception to that. And then I ran into him early, but I did not actually engage with Colonel Mundy until after like 2 years of working on this. And then soon after that was Colonel Davis. And both of them were very open and gave me all kinds of great information. Colonel Davis was, oh my gosh, the guy was awesome. we still talk. So
I have to add, yeah, I remember before Matador, you mentioned Colonel Davis. I remember before we departed from Matador, Colonel Davis came out and talked to the entire company. Yeah. And I remember one part of his speech that still sticks out to me this day. And it was, "Hey, gents, I know we're missing hunting season back in the States right now, but it's open hunting season back here. Kill everything you see." And like, you know, and that's kind of paraphrasing and it's probably misinterpreting some of the elements of it, but I remember like some of those specifics right there. And it's like, that really stuck out to me. It's like, okay, it's time to become relatively unhinged and we are out there going to fight an enemy. And that's what we did. It's like, we took his words and we put it to purpose.
Yeah. And I have to say the moral courage and leadership by Colonel Davis, just to add to Matt's story, I mean, he looks like a model Marine. He's got a heavy New York accent, right? So a lot of leaders before a battle. I mean, I remember before a raid, there was a certain officer who came down and like, I'm in the turret of an AAV. We're going out like our back gate. And he's reviewing the ROE rules with us to get the training requirement in before we're about to launch into a raid, right? So but, you know, I'm like, oh, dear Lord, you know, like this is, you know, like the senior leaders, he clearly was well within the law of armed conflict, right? But he sat there in front of the Marines, much like in my mind, you know, like Eisenhower did in meeting with the airborne troops, knowing that, you know, in his mind, he's sending 80% to his death. Colonel Davis had the moral courage to stand there and answer questions like what Marines care about, like, you know, hey, if I think there is a suicide vehicle standing there, can I pump a 203 grenade into it? And he had that courage. He had the right conviction. He was a leader. And you had faith that your leadership and every command was supporting you. And I remember that, too. And I admire him for that because he's going on the record. And I mean, if anyone should have been a general officer, it should have been Colonel Davis. But I just admire him for that. And also as like a junior leader, it takes a lot of pressure off you to balance these two things, right? Like we're in the profession of arms. We're going in, we're going to be shooting 4 McClicks. And you have a lot of pressure on you. And I think Colonel Davis's speech there, his accent, his demeanor, his charisma, was exactly what we needed. So I'm very appreciative of him, and I remember that a little bit more distinctly now, Matt, from it.
Yeah. I and you know, you kind of talk about accents and you kind of talk about demeanor and all that kind of stuff. And it you know, I'm not, I know we said kind of focus on the positives, but it's like that's what you remember as Marines. Like, you remember two types of Marines. You remember, like, the New York, you know, the accent and all that kind of stuff. And then you remember like the Southern boys, like, you know, hey, I'm from Miami, but
there are I know.
You know, there's times I have that Southern drawl, but it's like, you know, Sean, you have that Southern drawl. You remember certain aspects of Marines, and, like, you know, us enlisted side, like, you know, we're the Southern boys. We're going out to fight. We're going out to hunt. But, you know, and I'm not trying to draw a negative connotation here, but it's like your model officer that's trying to become that general officer appearance. It's like I, you know, since I was that young Marine in 2005, I was like, you know, there's certain officers I, you know, I just don't appreciate it. And they have that Southern Baptist, that Southern Baptist kind of speak. And it's like a polished type accent that they just practice in front of a mirror. And this is a speech I'm going to have, and this is how I'm going to translate it. And it's like, I don't want to follow that necessarily, but it's like this guy who's hyperactive in a sense. And he's like, hey, you guys are going to go do this, and I'm going to back you up. That's the guy I'm going to follow. I don't know. Just my perspective on things. And it's like, that's one of the things I appreciated from him. It's one of the things I appreciated from you. And then the good old Southern boy thing, that's what I appreciated from you, Sean.
That's something. Sorry to interject. That's something that I think Ajax should capture quite well in your depictions of individuals, right? You talk a little bit about, like, physical characteristics, but you kind of tie their personalities into either the dialects, the accent, where they're from. And I, you know, that's, you know, you're a lot of this is historical. A lot of this is fact-based, but there is a little bit of artistic or writerly license that you can take in bringing these people out.
Thank you for that. Thank you. Cause I wasn't sure I accomplished that. So thank you.
No, I mean, like, when Matt was, like, listing off people from different parts of the country, I'm like, yeah, no guy from there, no guy from there. And the same thing when I was reading the book, like, you would say somebody had, like, you know, I think it was an Irish brogue or, like, a Boston brogue at one point. I was like,
Clemmy.
Yeah.
Clemmy.
You feel like you know those people, because serving in the Marine Corps, you've met a lot of those people. My next question. So, Ajax, you talked about this a little bit. When you're doing your interviews, some people were, you know, it took a while for some people to open up, and some people never really opened up to you. And it makes sense. It's a very personal experience, and some people are comfortable talking about it, and some people aren't. But the next question is for Chris, Sean, and Matt. Is there an account from 3-2 Kilo Company that you think might have fleshed out things a little better? Is there someone's narrative that you feel like could have been added, and for whatever reason they just weren't able to give it? Chris, we'll start with you.
You know, because of the timeline on the book, and I think I was on a walk and I was talking, I live next to a nature preserve. I would, unfortunately, I think some of the epilogue stories were the ones that were tragic. And, you know, I mean, I was just reminded when Sean came on that he retired in 2009, right? Like, I just didn't have timelines in my head. You know, I'd forgotten they had 18 years in by the time we were there. And I would be fascinated to figure out where people went and what they did. So I always like an epilogue. Like, I loved in the movie Animal House, they have an epilogue. And I would have liked to have learned where people ended up. And I think just how life works, sometimes the more tragic things, you know, appear, and we capture that, and that's important. And I remember Ajax, I forget your exact words. I'm like, I know you're going to kill me, but can we do an epilogue? And you're like, I am done. Like, you know, like, I mean, you said it'd be great, but, like, it's taken long enough. And Ajax is a good guy, right? Like, he's a really good. And I think one of the things he doesn't say is in these 200 plus interviews, this is like a catharsis for some of the Marines and sailors, right? To voice, to piece things together, to have someone listen. I mean, that's some of the reason why it has such an extended timeline. That's also the reason why it's a great book. But I would have loved to have seen where everyone ended up. And I think there'd be a lot of surprises. And I you know, it's like Facebook, right? But I'm like texting, man, I'm so proud of him, how far he's gone, and to have a successful career, and to see a Marine do so well. And I would love to do that with so many others and learn, just like a reunion. So anyways, that would be my piece that I would add.
Okay. Yeah, very well said. Sean?
I really liked the scene. He wasn't mentioning that much. I don't know if he just didn't want to talk about it because it might have been hard. Getting Lynch's perspective on some things.
Yeah,
he did. He was out a lot. He was hit twice. I started calling him Mind Mag Lynch. He'd always find a mine in the middle of the desert. It wasn't like we were on a roadway or nothing.
He got hit like by 5 IEDs throughout his career. Not just that deployment, but his career.
But he was very intelligent, and he loved the Marines, and he was always out there amongst the battlefield. If it wasn't running ammo, resupplying ammo, chow, water, I mean, he would go, even when we were in, we'd go firm and we'd be sitting in our little headquarters building, he'd be heading out to go check on the hey boss, I'm going down here. He comes to, hey boss, I'm going down, check on first platoon, or I'm going over here. And he would get in, and he, you know, he just, like, I know Matt's probably, he'd just go in and start shooting shit with the Marines and telling stories and get them laughing. And I mean, I'd really like to maybe see more from him. Like I said, I understand some people didn't want to talk about it.
Sure.
And want to put it in the past. And that might've been him, but probably his would have been his, and maybe Donnie Brazil. I didn't see much in there from Donnie, from India Company. It was mostly Gunny Hogenkamp and Captain DiOrio and their XO. Those two would be the ones I would have liked to probably seen something from. But I agree with also Chris, epilogue would have been cool, but I mean, I know it's busy. That's what I got Facebook for.
Yeah, exactly.
I keep a lot of them. A lot of the Marines have done very well for themselves, got degrees and went on and done bigger and better things. And it's good to see.
Let me interject something here on this topic. I think there's a unfortunate and I think the popular culture depicts veterans completely in the wrong light. There's a strain of popular culture in America that thinks of combat veterans as victims, as, you know, they're damaged, they've had this traumatic experience, you know, and some of that, unfortunately, we actually feed into that, and we dwell on things that happened or friends that were lost and, you know, how tough it was, that kind of thing. But I believe the truth is exactly the opposite. I think these experiences, and by the way, I have to caveat, I am not a combat veteran. I don't claim to be. I had not a smidgen of the kind of experiences these guys had. So I respect them greatly. And that's part of why I wrote the book. But I believe that these extreme experiences actually build character and create layers of resiliency and knowledge and understanding that, you know, are just absolute. There are advantages. Kind of like what we were joking about with Chris in the boardroom, you know, there's just whole perspectives that other people just don't have. So far from being victims, I think it actually builds them and creates a different kind of man, a better, well, and women, by the way, that have capabilities that most people just don't have. So most of the veterans that I've spoken with and interacted with have had great successes,
yeah,
and built companies. A lot of service oriented. They're either, you know, police, fire department, teachers, in other, and a lot of them are serving other veterans. So at the end of a book called this, a chapter called The Struggle, I actually address that. And there are some epilogue stories of guys that have gone on to do some really cool things, just a few of them. But I think they're emblematic of the wider, not just 3-2, but the wider community. And they have tackled those, if you want to call them demons, you know, the demons from, you know, when they saw some really crazy things, and they've overcome them. Matt, I think you're a prime example of that. So anyway, I just want to make sure that that comes across. And I believe that this book actually portrays that really well. I went to the last part of the book talks about the fallen and the struggle that the guys, when they come home. So.
Yeah. Well said, Ajax. But Matt, any other perspectives you feel like would have added?
Maybe it's a selfish perspective. Mainly because, you know, from our company, it was Larry, that passed. I would have, you know, Borch and I reconnected a few years ago. Rainey, you know, him and I have been speaking throughout the period of my career, and, you know, him, his wife and I are friends on Facebook. And we actually talked last week, and then Brandon Gale. And I haven't talked to Gale in quite a while, and Gale and I were kind of close back then. And I understand everybody has their reservations about, you know, speaking about experiences. And I remember Gale, whenever we were on that deployment, he looked like he was 15 years old. We came back, he went on the Habania deployment, he looked like he was 60 years old. And I know that deployment had a huge mental and physical strain on him. Coming from that side, it was just, you know, from the lower level, it was like, you know, and thinking from the lower level at this point in my life, those are perspectives, other perspectives I would have loved to have seen. And I understand, you know, the reservations about coming on and speaking on the record and stuff like that. And I have to agree with Sean as well in terms of Lynch, you know, Tracy Lynch. I mentioned it before we started recording, like, you know, that guy is a phenomenal leader, absolute professional, absolute war fighter. The guy, like, when you epitomize a Marine, like, that is one of those individuals that you think of, like, the picture perfect poster Marine, you know, as a gunny himself, you know, when he was a gunny, and even as a sergeant major, like, his appearance didn't change whatsoever. But he's, you know, just a phenomenal human being. I remember the leadership skills that he taught me, just by the way he acted. And, you know, that's something that every Marine should emulate. And to hear his perspective of combat through his voice would have been absolutely beautiful.
Yeah. Well said. But I'll let you ask the next question, Matt.
So this one kind of rings hard for me, and this is for both you, Chris and Sean. During our deployment, you two had to have had conversations about the mental state of the Marines. And Ajax did a good job of depicting the instances in which you needed to be human with the Marines, and in the wake of losing someone to combat, you also needed to reorient and focus Marines during redeployment, ensuring them that their sacrifice had meaning. Can you give give some insight on the conversations a CO and a senior enlisted advisor would have about their unit and what touch points were important? And how did you identify the emotional cores of the unit and how did you tap into them? And I guess I'll give one perspective that I remember very vividly. And it was after Operation Matador. You know, I remember, Chris, you bringing the entire company in after we finally got back to Alkheim. And it was late that night because I remember even after we finished the operation, hitting close to the Syrian border, you know, we went back to New Ubaidi. Then we finally got back to Camp Alkheim. And every single person, and I'm pretty sure that picture was taken shortly after everyone had gotten back from Matador. We were exhausted. We were tough. We were battle hardened, you know, and we were ready just to crash at that point. What perspectives and what went through both of your minds and what conversations did you have with each other in order to keep everyone going? Because I think, and I don't mean to drag on, but, you know, if anybody listens to this, especially senior Marines or even junior Marines listen to this, this is a perspective that I think can teach every Marine that's about to go into combat the conversations that need to be had whenever, you know, you lose somebody close.
Yeah, I'm gonna paraphrase my thoughts. The time I realized I had a leadership challenge was, it was at the end of the deployment. Lieutenant Bullock's platoon had done a raid, went well, and the decision was to do a ground medevac, and there was tension between the battalion commander and myself not to bring a bird into like the target and the objective. So there was a ground medevac back to Alkheim of this HVT. It was HVT number 3 in our AO. So, you know, congrats to First Platoon. But like they come through the wire and like I don't hear the radio call for like the shock trauma platoon. And Lieutenant Bullock was fleeting up to be the XO for the next deployment. And I was sort of switching gears, knowing that I'm not going to go on the next deployment, but we need to have some ascension in the ranks. And Lieutenant Bullock was an outstanding officer. But he was like a game day guy. So I was always in his knickers about prepping and after actions. And we don't know where this wounded insurgent's at. And I run, after having tension with my battalion commander, I run out to like our area and I see Bullock, who's, he's a big, tough guy. He's having an after action. And I run up and I see this lump by Bullock's feet.
Laying on the ground.
And I'm like, look, where are you at the shock trap? And he looked at me, he's like, sir, I'm doing an after action. And the Marines are in a school circle, just turns back to them. And he's like, all right, like, what do we need to work on? And there's this insurgent laying down, like off to the side in this school circle, struggling to breathe. And I'm like, get this guy to shock trauma, right? Like right now. And the Marines picked him up. And if you were looking at this, you would almost assume that the Marines were faking it like bravado. They were just hard. They were callous. They didn't care. They almost lost some guys that night. And they just threw this guy in the back of a Humvee and took him to shock trauma. I realized then, like, how do you tell this Marine to drive 55 miles an hour in 2 weeks? How do you, and I think I went to First Sergeant Gregory. I mean, I think I did, but I had some discussions and I had some real concerns because that incident really didn't bother me. I understood like the warfighting ethos and I understood how things progress. I just wanted to do right by the Marines. And then I think the only distinct thing that I'll say is we were flying back. I was the senior person on the plane. And we landed in Shannon, Ireland, and I made a call that the Marines could drink. And the reason why is I wanted to decompression, right? I wanted to identify. I wanted to see. And then, you know, First Sergeant Gregory's like, what, a two beer? I said, just don't have a limit. Just we don't announce it. We don't say three. We don't say two. Let's just get it out of our system, because I want to have a decompression way. And I was trying to do things, but you know, I had some Army Lieutenant Colonel come up to me and, you know, say that we're violating, but I could decide it. So no one ever gets my last name right. So I told, like, I don't know if you remember that, Sean, like the guys, he was going to arrest me or something like that. Yeah. And I was like, we just got back from a fucking hard combat deployment. My name's Ieva, go tell General whoever and we'll drink. But I knew I had a problem on my hands. I thought we did a good job. When you start reading about the book and you realize some folks and some other incidents, I wish I would have done better, and we recognized it. And I think it was a team, but those conversations are hard. I think meeting parents as a parent was also hard, the families. And you know, we put up the Philippines on the beach to honor them, and we're doing this all on the fly. It was all like, you know, like a potluck dinner, getting resources together to try to do our best. I wish the service, I wish some of the other things would have done a better job. We realized it, and we're doing the best we could when we can. But allowing Marines to drink in Shannon, Ireland isn't the solution, right? Having a great lecture or a great ceremony or doing things. But I do remember at Al Asad, I wanted to get in our battle gear and thank every Marine after watching the company video, and have that personal touch and say something personal and have that man-to-man, intimate, if you will, relationship. So those are some of the memories I have. I watch presidents. I mean, Obama and Bush are two different men. Both say they have no regrets. I don't understand how. I have regrets on that issue, that I think I did the best I could at the time. Retrospect, I wish I would have done 10 times better or done stuff. So those are images that I have as a company commander at the time.
Before you start, Sean, I just want to say, like, reading through the book and seeing after, you know, Lieutenant Smith called on the radio, said, you know, we have a KIA, and you asked friendly or enemy, and he said friendly. And, you know, one of the things that really, you know, these are the things that you don't hear about until, like, you read the book. And you were more of a friend, a father figure, a brother, and just, you know, hey, what do you need? Like, those are things that really ring out with me. And those are perspectives that you can't be trained for. Like, those are things that you inherent human nature and how you are raised and how you are brought up. Those things aren't learned. Like, those are human aspects to your character that really drive and bring my point forward, which is, it, you know, it's a beautiful thing. And then the other perspective, you mentioned Shannon, Ireland, and drinking, and it reminded me of aspects of everybody running off the plane, you know. And like, I remember Operation Matador. I was smoking three packs a day on that. I ran out of two cartons of cigarettes in like two days, you know, but we ran to the duty free shop. We bought cigarettes. Then we bought bottles of Jack Daniels. And then we went outside. We were chain smoking cigarettes, and then we were chugging bottles of Jack Daniels before we got back on the plane, and we took off with one bathroom working on the entire plane while we were flying back.
Yeah, blew the heads up.
You know, but the when I was in Afghanistan, you know, we were RC Southwest. The British, they stop and do a 3-day. Probably not off the same type, maybe for the Royal Marines in Sangin, but they do a 3-day decompression in Cyprus. Mm-hmm. And, you know, like, we did a 3-hour decompression in Shannon, Ireland. And part of it, I mean, you know, Sean and I were still leaders. We're looking to see who's the wild ones, right? Like, who's the exception? So this was a decompression, because I would rather have that than be the first time that you get your cigarette, your beer, your whatever is when they're on their own. You don't have that you go from massive tight supervision to not. But that was our attempt at doing a decompression. Go ahead, Sean.
Yeah, in a semi-controlled environment, I had you on the plane. I knew I could.
Yeah, exactly.
Tie you to the chair if I had to.
0 and 1 is what I remember.
Yeah, I would have to say kind of the same thing. I mean, we had discussions after every time we, you know, the two casualties we took, major op. Number one, just having the ceremonies, the memorial ceremonies, immediately following, you know, because I wanted you to mourn your losses of your fellow Marines, and we all needed to do that. But two, I wanted to get it done immediately. And then, you know, a lot of times we would be gearing up for another op, or we'd schedule some type of training shortly thereafter to get your minds off of it. This is why we're in theater. I'll tell you what made me nervous. I don't know if y'all remember, but there was a rumor going around that they wanted to send us, Katrina just happened, and they wanted to send us they were talking about sending us to New Orleans to do security. And I was like, are they kidding me? You want to take these hardened Marine combat Marines to New Orleans? I said, they'll be killing people wholesale down there.
Oh yeah. That would have been,
funny is last week, me and Ajax were on the Former Action Guys podcast, and I mentioned that. And like, I remember Lieutenant Smith coming in and telling me, Staff Sergeant Hansen, I believe Rainey, Lockwood, we were all playing Madden in Staff Sergeant Hansen's hooch at the time. And Lieutenant Smith came in and was like, hey, I just wanted to give you a warning order. There's a potential that we could be going over to Katrina to help with the humanitarian relief aid over there. And I remember looking straight at Lieutenant Smith at the time and saying, if they send us over there, there's going to be more dead people over there from us shooting them than what we just killed over here in Iraq.
Yeah. Yeah. So I was like, thank God that didn't come to fruition, because that'd have been a bad, bad thing. But once we did that, like you said, the decompression in Shannon, Ireland, and let's be honest, at that point in time, the Marine Corps hadn't really got down to how we decompress, and you know, the whole medical eval when you got back, the 30 days back, and all that. We were just learning. That was
on the fly.
That was just getting learned on the fly, getting put into places, and it was really kind of left up to the unit to try to figure it out. There was no real guidance. You know, they just had us for the assessment, medical assessment. They just had you fill out a piece of paper when we got back and turn it in, and that was it. There was no sitting down with somebody, talking to them, you know, getting real deep with the Marines prior to them taking off or getting out and stuff like that. So it was, we did have a conversation about what we could do to mitigate getting back and going on leave. Because like you said, I mean, even I, you know, first time getting back driving, every piece of trash on the side of the road, every little hole I'm looking at. And then not long after I got back, I went to the First Sergeant's Symposium up in Quantico, because I had missed it the first year because I was in Iraq. And I'm going down 95, and we've been back maybe 2 months. And a daggone semi, I was next to a semi, I wanted to tires blew, and I felt the concussion push my truck over, and I shit my pants. I had to pull over and stop and sit there for like 30 minutes. My heart's racing. I thought I thought I died. So I'm saying, man, immediately started thinking about, you know, how the Marines dealing with this. What are they doing? Sure. How are they coping with the everyday life? Going down the road, just driving down the road, you're picking out stuff. You're so used to it. You're, you know, always in that high yellow orange zone. So it was definitely conversations we had of what we could do to help mitigate. But you know, it was just kind of do the best we could do. And like you said, the thing in Ireland, you know, once we did, I was good with it. We got everybody back home safe. Yeah, we had some people getting a little sick on the airplane, but that was all.
Let me tell a quick story. It's in the book at the end of chapter 29, but Chris Reith, who was a squad leader up in India Company. So he comes back and he's, they're after the leave or whatever, and they're back in their, day to day. But there's a firing range just down the street, I guess, from the battalion headquarters. Do you guys know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. There's a pistol range. So it's down there.
within blocks, I guess. And during the day, you're doing your duties, there's firing going off and Marines are flinching. Marines are, ducking instinctively because of this firing, even though they know it's just the range, but it's just ingrained. These are India guys that had been up in Gannon, but he talks about that. And that kind of is the last scene of one of the chapters. So,
Ajax, for me on that note, in sort of Sean's memory is, I try to use, my combat experience with Kilo and other combat experiences. It makes me hyper aware, right? Like it gives me an advantage in life to understand what's going on, what's unfolding, to know where I'm at, to know like all these other things. And then I also think it teaches you to be a survivor, right? Like it teaches you how to navigate things. And you mentioned resiliency, but for me, like I'm, and maybe some people saw it during like COVID or the pandemic, that, when you're in a combat tour, like I said, you're out, there's no rules. There's no timeout. There's no one in to provide this. You're just on your own. You got to work it out. And often, sometimes I feel as a veteran, particularly in this area of the country, like New Jersey, there's others who don't understand or don't have that perspective. But I will say that some things that I love about like life in America with structure, rules, and other stuff, until you don't experience that, you don't have that POV. And I'm grateful for it. I'm grateful for it. I'm also grateful to have, served with like really strong guys, like you mentioned, like a Gunny Lit. I mean, he's hard as woodpecker lips, right? Like, you meet so many different people. And this is like a little bit of a sidebar. When I was in Afghanistan, I was a staff officer. I would smoke cigars, and there was this Marine who smoked cigarettes, and he was like a kennel master. And like, we just sort of timed with each other. And I learned all about military working dogs and being a kennel master. And what I loved about the Marine Corps and what I loved about my times, you learn so much for so many different people. I had never run a kennel in my life, but just by smoking a cigar every night with this corporal, he had taught me about his job and all the things. And I'm really, really appreciative to experience, to know different perspectives, different lives, different parts of the country. But that toughness is still there. And I'm very grateful for it. I think it would suck to go through life not being aware. Not being aware and other things like that. So I'm grateful for it.
Appreciate the context that the two of you gave. Just not a lot of Marines get a chance to, I guess be privy to the conversations that a CO and a First Sergeant have. Just reading through some of those chapters that Ajax wrote, having done company command myself, conversations I had with my First Sergeant. Different situation for you guys, especially with the redeployment. Sure. Not having any idea how to manage that. Having Matt, how drunk were you in Ireland?
I was one of the reasons why that bathroom was shut down.
Okay. I'm proud of you, man.
Thank you.
but we're getting to the end of the questions, wrapping up, but this next one is for you, Ajax. So I'm kind of thinking about like war literature, and Bastards and Brothers is definitely a work of war literature. Looking at previous conflicts, I think the books that came out of like, say, World War One, All Is Quiet on the Western Front, out of Vietnam, I'd say like the things they carried really stands out to me. But out of OIF and OEF, I think I'm seeing a lot more nonfiction historical narratives. Do you have any perspective of why you think that is? And what are your inspirations? Like, what books do you read and look up to and did you have in mind while you're writing this?
I'll go with that one first. It's actually a trio, and it's from Bing West, who I think wrote the seminal works of the Iraq War in three volumes. He's got The March Up. In fact, they're on my shelf. I'm looking at them right now. So The March Up, about the 2003 invasion and the Marine part of it. What's the Fallujah book? I just was thinking about it. No True Glory, which is about Fallujah and the lead up to Fallujah. And then The Strongest Tribe, which is about basically the awakening, and what we talked about before. And he talks very briefly in there about Al-Qaim. In fact, has an interview with some of the guys that were there. But those three, if you had to read about the Iraq War and get context, those three books is what I would recommend. And Bing West is a noted author, a really interesting guy, former Vietnam Marine, who is later on, Assistant Secretary of something? I can't remember. Secretary of Defense for, I can't remember what his title was, but really interesting guy. And I was able to get an endorsement from him. I wanted him to write the foreword. Busy, busy man. So, but he gave me a really strong endorsement. So as far as, what was the first part of the game?
A lot of the notable works at OIF.
Why not more fiction? And I ran into this when I had to get the book cleared through DOD. Huge backlog. It's funny, when I went to the agency to get it cleared, because there were some things in there that I included that I was wondering if they were, first of all, you know, I'm obligated because I was, you know, there, so I had to get it cleared, but that took like 2 weeks. It was really quick and easy and they had no issues, but getting it through the Pentagon was just a nightmare. It took like 9 months. It was ridiculous. And it wasn't a nightmare, and you know, it just took a long time. They really had no, you know, I have a funny story about that. I'm going to tell on them because they were such pains in the ass. So it had to get shopped out to Special Operations Command because I mentioned a lot of that stuff. And one of my chapters, I called it Black and White because of black side soft and white side soft, right? And these are common terms, right? This is, anybody who knows anything about Special Operations Forces has heard black side, white side. And so I named it Black and White. Well, whoever did the reviewing came back and said, no, you can't say black side and white side. And by the way, you have to change the name of the chapter. You can't say black and white. I was just like, you got to be kidding me. And I don't know the reason for it. What I assume is that it's basically a political correct thing. They just don't want, it's like, really? Black and white? That's your problem? And it took them 9 months to have me to change the name of the chapter called Black and White. And then I changed it to Gray Zones. It's like, okay, whatever. Yes. Just like, oh my gosh. So that was frustrating. But a lot of authors are coming out now. There's a lot of people writing about Afghanistan and Iraq. So I'm just one of a stream of things coming out. And that's when I realized that it's like, yeah, you're just one guy out of 50 that are going through the process right now. That's great. That's actually awesome. There's so many stories. I mean, in one way, 3-2 is a very typical story. A Marine battalion at war in a hot spot. You can find dozens of those stories. I think there's a lot of other layers to this that make it unique, but there are many other, I'm looking at a bookshelf full of them. That I've read about, units. One thing unique about Bastards and Brothers is it's a battalion level book and provides the regimental scale too. So it's got both very personal content or personal stories along with the operational context. So that's something that's I don't see in many books at all. I can think of only one other book that's written at a battalion level. And I think you're going to see more, and that's all to the good. And I think there's already been a lot of books on Afghanistan, but I think you're going to see another wave of Afghanistan veterans that are going to start telling their story. It's a much more complex story, frankly, but
it went on. I think, Frank, your question is really interesting. Like, it, gotta be careful here, but if you look on my bookshelf, like Catch 22, these are books that I sort of
can't believe I forgot to mention Catch 22.
Yeah. I mean, I've read that five times. I think one of the reasons, and I live and I work in Manhattan, I think there's a danger. If you would have asked me back in 2005 during this deployment, if a draft was a good thing, I'd have said no. Now there's a part of me that says, well, you know, and you start looking at, you know, Marines and other stuff, there's a little bit of a caste system in our today's military that only a few percent of America serves. And I think fiction wouldn't serve like a larger audience base. More people could read the nonfiction because they can't relate to it. They can't relate to fiction. All Quiet on the Western Front, you serve in the trenches for a year, you get the book real quick. So to me, I think we're in a danger that you could just deploy battalions and you could tie a yellow ribbon, you can make donations, you could put a bumper sticker, but you may not have skin in the game. Mm-hmm. Ajax, I don't know if it's mentioned about your son, you know, who is a Ranger, who's done a lot of deployments.
That was a subliminal motivation.
Yeah, right.
So I couldn't really write about him, you know. First of all, the Rangers, everything's classified. Sure. But but also very episodic. He doesn't even know what happened. He was on a helicopter, they got off the helicopter, they kicked in the door, and then they got back on it. You know, it's like very, very episodic at that level. And there are some books that go into what's happened. In fact, I'm looking at him right now. Run to the Sound of the Guns, another one of his platoon sergeants that wrote a book. But definitely laced to this. And right after this, you tell your story about how you got Fury as the call sign. My son's name is David, and he's now a first sergeant, by the way, Sean. And hope he listens to some of this if he has time. He doesn't have time, really. But he's now the first sergeant in 2nd Ranger Battalion. It's the same company, Bravo Company, that he started at as a PFC. Wow. He has worked through what he's at 12 combat deployments to Iraq and Afghanistan at the tip of the spear, doing fantastic, doing well. But yeah, in a way, it's kind of like, okay, I can't write about my son, but here's a group of warriors that I can define, and I can reach out to them, and I can establish. So in a way, you're kind of like the ersatz son that I
can
write about. But yeah, tell your story about the call sign.
I think. You know, my son's name, and actually one of the reasons why I was late to the podcast is my son just returned from college today in Colorado. He's in Air Force, ROTC. Yeah. So it's like the black sheep of the family. But anyways, we were in a battalion meeting, and I do think that not only like Hilo was a fire brigade, but we were economy of force. And I think the battalion, because of all the good things, put a lot on us. But we're like at a meeting, and like they're like, your call sign is like a prowler call sign.
It was voodoo, right?
Yeah, voodoo. And they're like, you can't use this. And I'm like, it was just after like, hey, you don't get this, you don't get that. And it's like, oh, by the way, like the commo, who's the S6. So he's like sixth in the order of briefing, is like, oh, by the way, you can't use your call sign. And I'm like, come on, guys. So my son is named after my grandfather, Fiorello. We call him Fury. And I just said, fine, just call us Fury. So it's personal to me that became our call sign. What it taught me though is you know, and my son's older, and like I said, he's now 19. My daughter's thinking about serving too. It taught me that, you know, I'm in charge of other people's sons, and you know, I have to give them like a fighting chance, and that's where, you know, tie goes to the Marine. I have to support them. I have to mentor them. I have to take care of them, because I really believe that our youth is America's treasure. And, you know, I took that to heart and did the best I can. So for me, it wasn't only about Fury being like my son, but it was a reminder that you're in charge of other people's, you know, children. And I think I would want someone to treat my son the same way. And I've always used that even today, as like a litmus test. You know, what was it fair? What was it not fair? So that's how it came about that, you know, the call sign became Fury. It was really sort of some prowler squadron named Voodoo. We had to pick Fury.
I think that's a great emblem, really, of, you know, several layers there. So Fury being Kilo Company, a furious fighter, you know, it's like,
yeah,
when you went up against Kilo, you were going to face the Fury, man.
Yeah, I mean, the Marines did so well. And I have to give also, we talked about the staff NCOs, and we know that one thing that I've always said is I've been benefited tremendously from like the U.S. government, education, training. Certainly when I was a company commander, the Marine Corps had trained me well for that job. Right. Like I had gone through 6 months of the basic school. I've been to infantry officers course. Myself and my college roommate were the only infantry officers to go to field artillery class 6 months. So when you look at how much training I had before I became a company commander and before I had Kilo, I had a headquarters company, H&S company. When you look at the squad leaders in Iraq, right? Like by organization and design, these are supposed to be E5s. I don't know, Sean, how many Lance Corporal squad leaders did we have? Half? Third?
At least a half.
You know, so when you look at this conflict, it's one at the squad level, and you have Marines who haven't been to like a squad leader's course, right? Like they're on their first deployment. They just, you know, they have maybe 2 years in the Marine Corps. I was, and the part that would just drive me livid with senior officers is when they would say, just doing their job. Well, a Lance Corporal by definition, who's a squad leader, isn't just doing their job. They're really working like three levels up. And I found that amazing how well those squad leaders and really those NCOs did. You know, Matt's like one of them, because like, you just don't have a sergeant squad leader. It just doesn't happen. It just, it's like a purple unicorn running around out there. It's in the wild. So I'm also really, really, really proud of how those Marines did. At, you know, and now you look back and they're like, these guys are like 20. They can't drink in Shannon Island or whatever. So anyway, I'll pause there. I know that we're going to have to start wrapping up here.
Yeah. I just want to take a moment. Thank you all for, you know, spending time. We've been at this for quite a while, gentlemen. Really great discussion. Great opportunity to pick your guys' brains. Bastards and Brothers, you can go on bastardsandbrothers.com and you can pre-order it, hardcover or softcover. And it will come out around the November, December timeframe. Anything more concrete than that, Ajax?
Being printed soon, sooner than hopefully, but...
But it highly recommended. After I get through the semester, I'm definitely going to go back and read more in depth, not just skim and gut the book like I have. But as we're wrapping up, I'll just give everyone a chance to talk to the audience and say their last piece. We'll go Chris, Sean, Matt, and then we'll finish with you, Ajax. But Chris, floor is yours.
No, I'm so proud of the Marines and Sailors I serve with. I went back for my 25th college reunion and I talked to different folks. I went to the Naval Academy. So some are SEALs and had different experience. Some are pilots. Some are submarine officers and they had a different experience during the past two decades. The piece that I sort of realized is you know, you spend a life. I was meant to be Kilo Company's commander. Everything I learned, everything I did was for that moment. And anything else I accomplished professionally in life is just gravy. And I think sometimes in the military career that's up and out, you sort of define things in different ways. I am so proud of the Marines I serve with. I'm so proud of the job we did. I'm so proud how many Marines we went home. And I'm so proud that, you know, when you read the book, you know, Killer Kilo, just all the levels of operation we did in 7 months of intense combat. I'm just, you know, in retrospect, I'm in awe. So I remain humbled, very appreciative, and very cognizant of those who, you know, paid the ultimate sacrifice and the families. And I hope anything that we did, the next generation, whether it's my son or daughter, they don't have to deploy and fight the way that we had to fight, really undermanned, understaffed, and under-equipped, but we did the best we can.
Sean?
Yeah, again, I mean, Chris hit it on the nail head. Proud of the Marines. It was probably the pivotal point of my career, even though it was at the end. Just watching the Marines, they put me in awe every time we do a mission. Never hesitated, never complained. If they did, they didn't do it to my face anyway. they worked hard. I would like to add, back where Ajax was talking about that photo of the company officers, and we were talking about like they were, you know, constant. That's like a month. It's actually more than a month, because I'll tell you right now, Chris, even when we were back, he was constantly planning, doing his own intelligence gathering sales, tasking out the other officers. So they worked hard. They were on 24/7. He'd come in, get a couple hours sleep, go back, stay up half the night over in the S2 shop doing work, gathering information, setting up missions for us so we could be successful. So to watch him work was a great experience. And sir, I'd say, again, you're the reason we brought a lot of them home.
Thank you.
And again, Matt, guys like you made it happen. We just kind of pointed you in the right direction, gave you the tools, and the Marines did the work. All right. So again, I'm proud to be a part of Kilo 3-2, and proud to be part of this book. And AJ, I'm glad you wrote the book, because like I've always said, if we don't study and read history, then we're doomed to repeat it. We, in the future, future Marine Corps leaders can read this book, learn from it, and not make some of the mistakes and do some of the things a little different. So again, great. And only thing I will add, you said you went to your reunion, sir. Me and Matt's been talking. We're going to try to put together a Kilo 3-2.
Oh man, that's awesome. Yeah, let's do it. Let's do it. I'm
we'll
there.
We'll talk Shannon about Ireland. That.
Shannon, Ireland.
Yeah. That's all I got.
All right, Matt.
So I'll start with thanking you two gentlemen for, you know, agreeing to come on this. I know it's a lot different. It's, you know, and it's stressful in a different sense. But thank you. I appreciate this. And I think the Marines will appreciate this. You know, to all the Marines out there, thank you for everything you did on the deployment. You know, I was right there with you. I love you all, to the friends that I still speak to, especially, you know, another person I have to thank, and, you know, I consider a very dear friend is, you know, Master Guns Tim Hansen. I know, Sean, you're still keeping contact with him. You still get together with him. You know, he was a monumental figure, in my opinion, in Kilo Company at that time, especially with Second Platoon, with everything that we had gone through. He was the glue that kept everybody in line and focused on the next objective. So I have to say thank you for, you know, keeping us focused and keeping us alive. You know, when I pinned on Staff Sergeant, I asked him, I was like, I want you to be one of the individuals to pin me on, you know, So he, you know, even when I was getting out, you know, I was keeping in contact with him. And Ajax, thank you for giving me the opportunity to tell part of my story and to tell part of Kilo's story. I really appreciate that. But yeah, and to all the Marines out there, whether you served in 3-2, whether you served in another battalion, or you're currently in your first enlistment in the Marine Corps, no matter what you're going through, there are resources out there to help you. There's, you know, talk. One of the biggest things, and my wife probably fucking hates me for this, is I'm on my phone more than a fucking old woman. She often says I speak to, you know, people on the phone more in one day than she speaks to in 2 months, you know, and it's true. I do. I speak to people all the time. It's indicative to my position at work. It's indicative to what I do in the shooting community and, you know, and what I do on this podcast. I'm always constantly communicating with people. And that's kind of the that's what I lean back on when I'm going into a hard time. You know, I talk to people, and that's a message I want to get out there to other people. Just reach out to people that you love, you trust, and you have confidence in, and just talk to them. So that's all I really have.
Thanks, Matt. Ajax, floor is yours.
So I am actually, I'm humbled, deeply humbled. I mean, I went into this process being humble, being an Air Force puke, you know, and talking to these Marines, but I am deeply respectful for what they did, and for, you know, they didn't just do it for the country. They did it for each other, but they were there when their country needed them. And I am just so thankful and respectful, and, you know, it's just an honor now that I've met them. You know, I've met Chris in person. Soon I hope to meet Matt and Sean in person. I've met a few of the others, but these, you know, basically I'm seeing my heroes, the guys that I, you know, they've told me their stories, and they've, you know, kind of poured their hearts out to me in some cases. So it's just an honor. And I hope the book does them justice. I do believe that the book is something that every American should read, because it really highlights what a generation of Americans accomplished and did in these last 20 years. And it's emblematic of so much. So that's what I hope a wider audience will, you know, be able to access it and read it. But the other part of it is, I really hope that Marines and other, you know, anyone in the military can learn so much out of this. One of the other endorsements, by the way, is H.R. McMaster, who Army general, but with, you know, one of the heroes of the Gulf War, and then later became a 3-star and, you know, national security advisor. So he says every junior, you know, NCO, junior officer, and even senior leaders ought to read this. There's so many lessons embedded. We talked about some of them today. Some of them are just strictly tactical, but so many of the others are of that in-depth, you know, how do you come back? How do you maintain your morale and your, you know, your edge over the long term of many deployments? So there's so many valuable lessons in there, and, you know, check it out, bastardsandbrothers.com. And I just thank you guys for the opportunities I've had to meet you and talk to you and get to know you a little more.
Likewise.
Absolutely. To our listeners, if you're still with us, thank you for listening through. This is definitely our longest episode, but it's an important episode. So thank you very much for taking the time to listen, and let us know how we're doing.